Hey, I'm Kirk Harnack. It's This Week in Radio Tech. We're live at NAB 2012. Well, if you're watching this, I guess you're not watching live. But we did it live. We got some great guests, and Chris Tobin is with us live from NAB 2012 on This Week in Radio Tech next.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Radio Tech is brought to you by Cachefly at cachefly.com.
This is This Week in Radio Tech, episode 125, recorded April 18th, 2012, live from NAB. This Week in Radio Tech is brought to you by Axia Audio and the new Radius IP audio console on the web at axiaaudio.com. Hello and welcome. It's time for This Week in Radio Tech. I'm Kirk Harnack, your host. I'm so glad that you could join us, especially joining us where we are today. We are live at the NAB in Las Vegas, Nevada, where they have the NAB just every year for years and years now. The NAB, the National Association of Broadcasters, and it's radio and TV. And even though I'm on TV with you, I'm mostly on the radio side. So that's what the next couple of hours are going to be focusing on. Radio technologies, new things that are coming about, new associations, new agreements, and a little bit of new technology. And we're also going to discover some things about older technology, too. So let's jump right into it. My co-host with me here is Mr. Chris Tobin. Good morning.
Good morning.
I've hardly gotten to say hello to you.
It's been a very busy show.
Yes, it has.
But it's been fun.
Yes,
I'm having a good time.
Yeah, you look great.
Why, thank you.
You're looking
pretty good.
The best-dressed engineer in radio.
Considering what you guys have been going through, you're looking good.
Yeah, exactly.
I've heard about the parties.
Well, actually, last night, I'm delighted to say, a company that I work with, Linear Acoustic, had their 10th anniversary party.
Ooh.
And I got to tell you, the founders of Linear Acoustic, you know, they do audio processing for television. And if it wasn't for Linear Acoustic, the last Olympics would not have sounded so good.
Oh, is that so?
I'm not putting anybody else down, but
the sound guys, you know, the guys of the crew at the mixers,
Their technology that has this crowd control technology, so the crowd level is always appropriate, not, you know, drowning out the announcers and not, hey, is there anybody in there? Crickets, you know? And they have all cool methods for, like, if you have a two-channel stereo satellite system, but you need to get surround sound from one end to the other, no problem, they do that.
Oh, wow.
And,
nice.
That's the up-mix and down-mix, 5.1. You know, TV has a lot of interesting issues with stereo and surround.
Oh, yes. Even with mono.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Because when the stereo and the 5.1 surround don't mix properly, sometimes you hear nothing in mono.
That explains.
Or you hear the infamous comb filtering, that phasing sound.
Yeah.
Flanging, I guess, would be the proper word.
Well, anyway, Tim and Christina Carroll founded the company 10 years ago. Big party last night. And Frank Foti was there to speak as, you know, kind of the padrino, the godfather.
Of course.
And
kiss the ring.
Yeah. hadn't gone that far yet. I'm anticipating. So what have you been catching up on?
Walking around the show, actually catching up a lot of video encoding for streaming.
Oh, yeah.
So radio stations looking to monetize other means of program distribution.
Yeah.
It's been pretty cool.
Yeah. Now, some stations just put a webcam on the mic arm and send it to Ustream. Are you talking about more sophisticated stuff than that?
Well, there's some more sophisticated, but the Ustream approach or the webcam approach is working well. What I'm discovering is a lot of folks are realizing that if you use a computer and try to use a computer for call screening plus web streaming and other stuff, doesn't go well.
That's too much stuff to do.
So some of the professional stuff that's coming out is pretty cool.
Good.
We'll
catch up more as the show goes on, but we have a few guests, and I'm just
I'm
delighted to introduce our first guest from Ibiquity. Now, these are the guys that are responsible for the HD radio technology, and our first guest is Jeff Detweiler. Good morning.
Good morning, Kirk. Thanks for having me.
I'm just delighted that you're here. It's good to see you.
It's great to see you again. I think you're the only one that I've ever recommended on LinkedIn.
Well, thank you.
And it's created a lot of headaches for me because nobody else I want to recommend.
Oh, man. Well, thank you so much. Well, we haven't worked together close enough for you to know all the skeletons in my closet, which every skeleton in my closet, by the way, they each one deserved it. I'll tell you. So, Now, with ubiquity, HD radio, you know, there's so much industry back and forth, and there's the naysayers, and then there's the promoters of HD radio. And I've traveled a bit around the world, and I know that plenty of other countries are considering, and some have adopted HD radio. Here in the U.S., there are quite a few. How many stations in the U.S. are running
HD radio? About 2,100 right now.
Over 2,000?
Yep.
Okay. And so how many, so the just for the folks who don't know, to pick up HD radio, you need an HD radio receiver.
Yeah, it doesn't work very well without it. So you need an HD radio receiver.
Yeah.
It allows you to get the HD1 programming, which in the United States is a duplicate of the analog program. HD2 and HD3 can be new content. And we're now introducing new data services that a number of the OEM platforms, the automakers, are bringing forward traffic information, weather maps, things of that nature.
So, to see, I guess there's a lot of emphasis on the visual, on presenting, what, artist information?
Yeah, not only arts. Just the song title and artist, we're able to bring the cover art images along, and during commercial segments, be able to bring an image for a logo or a particular product placement along with a commercial.
Okay, all right. So if you're the local Ford dealer, you could have...
You could have a Ford logo or a nice picture of a F-150 pickup truck on there, and we think it's bringing a new element to radio that it hasn't, and perhaps a more equalizing dynamic with not only the internet media as well as television.
Well, now, I'm thinking of the car environment where you would already have a navigation system, a screen on the dashboard. Are there other environments where it would be appropriate, where you can show visual content?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked. We've got a new tabletop radio that will be selling for less than $100 that has the artist experience and the commercial images right on the front of the radio.
Now, for folks working in an office all day, they're in front of a computer, they may be streaming audio now. How do the technologies that you're working on and the integrations with auto manufacturers and radios, can a station leverage that same work into their web stream and get the same visual there?
Well, I'm glad you brought it up because there was a huge project that was undertaken just prior to NAB, and that was to get full interactivity on the chipset of a handheld cell phone,
yeah,
allowing for interactive background, images for artists, images for commercials, the ability to tweet and use Facebook interactively on that device. So we think that's the next major hurdle for radio, is to get into the devices people are carrying, whether that's a cell phone or an MP3, MP4 player.
So what was the big announcement earlier in NAB about chips and cell phones and HD?
Well, Intel, NAB Labs, and MS Interactive and HD Radio got together and developed a ZTE cell phone that has the HD radio chipset on there, low power consumption, full interactive back end that MS Interactive did, and provided all of the full interactive function on the handset.
Wow. So
we've got about 14 of them in our booth that you can come over and play with them.
It's pretty exciting. With Intel involved and some other names that you mentioned, it takes that kind of, I think the word is gravitas, to actually make this more than a science experiment. Make it, something is. That's going to be a real consumer product?
Well, certainly. And they're out shopping it with all of the major carriers. I mean, you can prototype a design like this, but you're not going to get to market unless you convince the carriers. But the carriers are looking for ways to offload their data. They're starting to run up against the wall, and this is a way for functionality that's in a broadcast mode that can be removed from their networks.
Now, we've had this discussion on our show before about this offloading data, and it seems that the argument at one time went to, no, they want you to use data so they can charge you for it, and now they want you to not use data so they can charge you for it.
Now,
and deliver it to the people.
It's content that, you know, really doesn't necessarily need to be on their network and would allow them to have the ability to leverage other vehicles, whether it's whether it's internet or HD radio. We really don't care. We want to be on those devices. It's the same business model for us.
Gotcha. Are there one thing about the technology I'm a little unclear on? If I have some kind of application on my cell phone or in my in-dash receiver, and I need to get data that's being transmitted by some FM radio station on an HD and with some ancillary data,
do I only get that data when I'm tuned to that FM station, or are there like dual tuner receivers that go grab data in the background, so to speak, from stations that you're not listening to right now?
There are dual tuner receivers. Matter of fact, I have a real nice JVC in-dash receiver. The second tuner on there is constantly pulling information, journal line, news, sports, and traffic information. It's all available interactively with the radio. So if I use the nav system, set a course, if there's a traffic event on the route I've plotted, it will let me know that there's a traffic event and I can reroute.
Okay. All right. Cool.
And it'll do that automatically or manually if you want.
I don't know if we've covered everything that you want to cover or not. We have a fairly limited time, and I want to make sure you get in what you wanted to.
Well, I think we're really approaching critical mass now. There's 28 auto manufacturers that are offering HD. Mm-hmm. There is 141 platforms that have been sourced. That means the particular models. 64 of those are standard. There's 2 million annually being sold on the OEM side.
Okay.
And... Mm-hmm. That means one receiver every 15 seconds is going into an automobile. That's pretty good.
Now, recently we've seen Ford ads with Mike Rowe talking about Ford selling one tire every 5 seconds. And there's an HD radio every 15 seconds?
Every 15 seconds.
My goodness.
And you probably have seen a number of the HD radio ads running with the auto manufacturers.
Yeah, yeah.
Big news for the show was the launch of Mexico.
Okay.
So we now
does that mean the Mexican government officially recognized or adopted?
They did a while back, but the official launch in Mexico City took place yesterday.
We had a
great conference here, and it was an awesome time. Had a little bit of an opportunity to talk with the broadcasters. They're really excited about the opportunity.
Cool. You have a question for Jeff?
Folks have asked me, portable HD radio. How many models should people expect by the summer or the holidays? And also, what's the booth number for those of us watching and listening right now who are at the show?
The booth is in the Central Hall, C148.
C148.
It's real close to the big NAB registration area.
It is.
Yes, I know where it is.
If you're coming in registration, you can't miss it. It's right off to the left.
Facing registration is right behind it.
Yep.
Yes.
The portables, there's both AudioVox and Insignia who have portable devices. Typically, they're in the $49 price range. Mm-hmm. There is a new one coming out that will have artist experience as well. So, I'm really excited about that segment. I think it's going to be an important growth area for us. And certainly the cell phone. It's going to take a little bit more work with the carriers, but we're getting very, very close.
When you say work with the carriers, I'm curious, what pushback do you get? Are they familiar?
They're looking at the feature set of the phone that you've built,
right?
And determining whether that's appropriate for their market and whether the radio feature is something that they want to get behind. As I indicated, many of the large carriers are now.
Okay. Yeah.
And I guess the other big announcement here at the show was General Motors. We now have HD radio standard on the brand new Traverse that will come standard with HD radio, and not only HD radio, but HD radio with artist experience.
Very cool. Very cool. Jeff, thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you being on top of this, and you have such a good way of relating to station engineers. You've been in radio stations plenty of times, and you know that world, and so I appreciate you being able to relate that. It just occurred to me, there's a guy that I really wanted to have on this show sometime before 11 o'clock. You know him, Alan Hartle.
Oh,
yeah. Is there any way that you could maybe encourage him to pop over here about 10:45 or so this morning?
I will be seeing Alan at 10 this morning.
Okay, so I don't know if he's available, but if he is, ask him to come on over here. I'd like to put him on, ask him a few questions.
I'll be happy to do that.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Kirk, Chris, thanks.
Okay,
thank you, Jeff.
All right. I'm curious about portable receivers myself. I bought one of those little Insignia receivers.
Yeah, those are great.
And now it's got a little screen on there, but the screen isn't for the artist experience stuff.
No.
Okay.
Now, it's the folks I talked to, some of the radio stations I'm working with, they've been asking about more variety, I guess, because the audience is particular about what they walk around with, whether it's be an Apple product or the other.
Now, your work with CBS, and something that I was alluding to with Jeff, and I don't know if it exists yet, but it seems like a radio station that implements all the data connectivity and databasing that you would need for artist experience, mm-hmm. Or at least the right tagging on your songs,
whatever it might be,
if you could have that work usable for your HD radio,
mm-hmm.
but also that same work and not a separate system usable for your stream. Is that how it works, or right now
you should be able to? probably most people have it separate because they're doing the, what do you call it, spot insertion.
Well, yeah.
So I'm not sure how many companies are all working together on that. But that, workflow-wise, that would make sense. That would be the way to go. And most stations, I've talked to some folks who do it that way.
Yeah.
They won't explain how they're doing it.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if
okay.
they're doing some workarounds with maybe licensing and whatnot. But, yeah, that would make sense. This way, whatever you change here at the front end propagates throughout all of your distribution channels,
yeah.
which is how it should go.
Well, if I were a program director and engineer for a station, I wouldn't want to have to do that work twice,
no,
once
no.
for my stream.
No.
Now, I realize for the stream you do have spot insertion
right.
that you don't have on HD, but you've got to take care of separate spots.
But all the metadata handling is now, I mean, pretty much standard stuff. So
is
it's
it?
XML
is
and
it?
A few other
You
things.
Can see, I'm part owner of this little group of small stations,
mm-hmm.
and we're not doing this stuff yet. We're doing a little bit of RDS,
right.
I haven't been involved with the
Well, the other question is the audience really, are they missing anything? Are you missing out by not giving it to them? Are they giving you feedback? Are they going to your competitor? Yeah.
When we put RDS on our FMs in American Samoa, we had to go to the local Ford dealer to find a car that had RDS so we could watch
it. Exactly.
And there were three on the lot.
Right, exactly.
Just three.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So Audix experience, unless you have the device that's going to decode it and give the experience or extend it from your radio station to the audience, if it's not there, you got to be careful not to go too fast and too too quick into it.
And but also we don't want a chicken egg situation where where people buy if the audience is buying these new cars,
mm-hmm.
and they have the capability and they punch up your station and it's blank or right. generic.
Well, yeah, well, RDS you in this day and age, 2012, you should be doing RDS.
Yeah.
Let's just say that up front.
Absolutely.
Title and artist and all the experiences that you can get with all the new data services, definitely do it, but step back, make the workflow a single line. Like you said, don't have six different operations going on to do the same thing. If you do that, then the cost of entry is proper, and then you can avoid the chicken or the egg and just say, we're doing it, because the overhead to you is minimal.
Good deal.
All right. That's my thing.
Well, next we have a couple of guests who I'm very, very excited to bring you. A couple of high power CEO kind of guys who have gotten together and decide to make the world a better place. Let me introduce to you, first of all, on stage left, on your left, radio right, is Mike Dosch from Axia and Telos. And that's the inventors of the LiveWire system. Good morning, Mike.
Good morning, Kirk.
And right next to Mike is Mr. Philipp Lawo. Who's the CEO of Lawo AG from Germany.
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good. Glad to hear
you.
Hey, go ahead and pull the microphones up close to you. They're close-talking mics. And so I understand that there's been a big announcement made on Sunday about a new world standard for getting extraordinarily high-quality audio around a radio facility, typically, maybe television too, that's going to work. It's going to make a lot of folks happy. Why don't you tell us what that means?
I think, first of all, we were very happy you're calling it this way because it's exactly what we see. We announced that there is a new partnership of LiveWire into Ravenna. Ravenna is a real-time audio streaming format for audio of IP, which goes from high-end production solutions to PC applications.
Mm-hmm.
And with the joining of LiveWire, we would say that now there is a solution for everyone based on the existing installed base of the LiveWire equipment, and including all the Ravenna partners. So we found it for sure the biggest solution that is available today.
You know, the viewers of this podcast are pretty familiar with LiveWire, as Axie is a sponsor, and we've talked about the technology a few times on the podcast. So LiveWire is this linear, basically unbuffered, real-time, low-latency stream can be mono, stereo, multi-channel. So how is Ravenna? Ravenna is a very similar thing, and for the best benefit of customers, it seems best to have these two be able to talk to each other. And is that what's happened here?
I would say this is a basic thing. Maybe just to point out, there's a difference.
Mm-hmm.
We have great respect for LiveWire and the companies that developed it, and I would really call them the pioneers of IP audio. We had the luck, I would say, to start later. So when we get into the IP development, we had the chance to use new technologies like IEEE 1588, clock synchronization coming from the industry.
Mm-hmm.
And by doing so, we had the chance to improve the technology based on these standards to a higher level.
Gotcha.
As Lawo is also a company doing production consoles for TV production, live recordings and everything, we have much higher channel cones. We have much higher requirements for synchronization, sure. phase alignments over the network, and all these topics. And all this was basic design rules for Ravenna.
Gotcha.
So we had the approach to make Ravenna at least as good as all the existing standards like MADI, AES, and whatever is out there. And for this reason, we were very proud that LiveWire now merged into that, and we found a way to be compatible, even in the way to get all the existing installed based products on board, and now make it a bigger system. Whereas the LiveWire legacy products stay, of course, as they are, mm-hmm. but they get a way to interface to the more modern technology of Ravenna, and being forming a bigger installation base for all of us.
Wow.
Okay. I want to ask Mike Dosch a couple of questions. Mike, what, you know, if Axia and the, pioneered this live wire, what, about 8, 9, 10 years ago or so?
About 10 years ago.
A lot of development.
Right.
So what was, and there's a lot of live wire on the air around the world right now, 3,000 consoles.
3,000 consoles, about 30,000 live wire devices active right now.
Wow. Okay. And if a live wire device can typically do 8 in, 8 out, eight times 30,000, that's a 250,000 streams.
Well, that would be the capacity. I'm not so sure that there's that many active streams, but okay, sure, that'd be great.
So what was your impetus to get together? We heard about this Ravenna standard emerging, what, about 3 years ago or so?
Mm-hmm.
And looked like it was going to have some interesting applications for a lot of European broadcasters, but in the TV segment, in the live sound segment, and production segments. What was your impetus to say, you know what, we really ought to see if we can partner with these guys?
Yeah, that's a great question, Kirk. It was actually at this show 1 year ago.
Oh.
I had just read a white paper published by Lawo ALC Networks. And this white paper was talking about the philosophy and the technology used in Ravenna. And as I was reading this white paper, I was thinking, you know, this sounds like us in terms of philosophy, technology, approach. One of the key philosophies that's important, I believe, to doing an IP audio standard is this idea of using as much standard technology as possible. And so what LiveWire has always done, and what Ravenna also does, is we took existing standards that existed from IETF, IEEE, and we took these standards and we bundled them together in a way that we were able to make a useful protocol. In other words, we're not trying to make a proprietary tech that people can't interface with. We're not trying to be exclusive. We're trying to be inclusive. And so as I was reading this paper, I was thinking, you know, these guys, philosophically, they want to have an open standard. They want to share it for free. They don't, you know, they're not going to try to use this as a barrier to lock out competitors or anything like that. And that sounds an awful lot like the way we think. Mm-hmm. And so I wandered over to the Lawo booth and asked, should we work together? and I was introduced to Philipp, and we agreed that we would have a co-opetition.
Oh, okay.
Yes. So we cooperate on IP audio, mm-hmm. and of course the announcement that we made is the result of a year of cooperating, where our LiveWire developers and the Ravenna developers have worked together for the last year to kind of mold and reshape Ravenna and also LiveWire in a way that they can work together.
So it has taken a meeting of minds of developers to get the I's dotted and the T's crossed,
yes.
and if we change this bit,
yes.
then these two things can...
Absolutely.
Yeah, that kind of thing.
Okay. Absolutely. But what we've learned through this process, Philipp may argue with me if I say this, but we've learned through this process that we're really not competitors. We love this cooperation, and the companies fit together so well, and our development teams merge together so well that this partnership has turned out to be, I think, the most exciting thing that I've done in the last 10 years, and I'm very excited about what we're doing together.
Well, viewers and listeners to this podcast know all about Axia because Axia makes smaller consoles that are radio station-sized. Now, Lawo recently came out with a couple of radio station-sized consoles, but for the most part, Philipp, why don't you tell me about the big consoles that Lawo makes? These things are just gorgeous pieces of engineering work, and...
Thank you.
You must have to have an engineering degree to use one of these things, but I'm sure you'd say, no, we make it easy to use.
Of course I say that. No, Lawo originated from the production world, and we're doing radio production consoles, TV production consoles for all kinds of broadcast stations, even to private broadcasters. We're doing the big events of the world, either the Olympics, the World Cup in soccer, or Formula One, America's Cup, all these things are done with Lawo consoles for production consoles. We're doing radio since many years already, but we've been, let's say, dedicated to the European market and extended to Asia. We're pretty new to the US, honestly, but even with the partnership now with Axia and the Telos Group, I would say this is a perfect fit because we're used to, let's say, the complex solutions. And our consoles are designed to be very flexible, very adaptable to customer needs. And of course, this flexibility brings a certain amount of complexity to how to handle them.
Sure.
But now I think with the partnership also on the technology side, we will find out to align this a bit more with the Axia line and give a full line of solutions together.
I really enjoyed the tour that I got through the Lawo booth and the fantastic application of technologies like iPads and various ways to remote control and set up and use consoles. That very effective ways for folks to get this technology to do what they need to do right then, right there, almost no matter where they are, if that at a remote site or in a different room in the facility. Hey, I've been hogging all the screen here. I'm so sorry.
That's okay.
Chris,
it's expected.
These guys are only here for another minute or two.
Two things. One, I applaud both of you for coming up with an open or a cooperative approach, which I prefer more open standards than the closed. You're right,
Thank
Mike.
You, Chris.
Also, I assume then if I'm a large facility, say I've worked in network radio facilities in the past, and I've worked with facilities where a mixed environment. So I've also, for disclosure, I've installed and used Axia systems, so you know I'm familiar with the concepts. So if I had a facility that was already an Axia plant, which there are many, as we know, and I decide, oh, you know what, our application would be nice because we've just purchased a radio station, or we've moved into television, media, video, and Lawo was there. The integration of the two, I take it, is very seamless.
It is now.
It is now. Right.
You know, as a result of this announcement, because to connect into a Lawo system, you can use a Ravenna interface someplace in the Lawo system, and that will enable you to share IP audio out of the Lawo system into an Axia system. And now, as Philipp was saying earlier, not only will the new Axia products be able to deal with Ravenna natively, but there's also a compatibility mode where this Ravenna stream and the LiveWire stream, these devices will be able to share. They'll be able to
coexist or
interoperate, I guess is the right word.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
And even all the way back to those devices that we sold 10 years ago, will be able to, with a firmware update, they will be able to communicate with a brand new Lawo console.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And you're right. It's just seamless. In fact, we have a demo. There's two demos. There's a demo in the Lawo booth, and there's a demo in the Telos booth. And it's very interesting for us because it represents a year's worth of working together.
Sure, sure.
But it's a very boring demo because you just plug in the RJ45 and the audio comes up, and that's it.
There's no wow factor.
But you know, it's almost the equivalent of taking a BMW engine and it fits in the Mercedes chassis too. You can move them back and forth. So and the demo is boring. You take the BMW engine out, put it in the Mercedes, and it runs.
Surprisingly.
Well, surprisingly, yeah. Yes. Wow. Gentlemen, thank you so much for being here. I wish we had more time to talk, but if folks want more information, if you're here at the NAB, there's in the Telos booth we have this demo, and in the Lawo booth, and both booths are in the central hall, right?
Exactly.
And then for information online, where could people look to find this?
Well, axiaaudio.com. Mm-hmm. We don't yet today have our white papers and documents up, but that should happen probably in the next week. So axiaaudio.com.
I'll warn our viewers and listeners that since Axia is a sponsor of this show, that as soon as those white papers up are up, I'll let them know.
Very good.
Okay. And Lawo is lawo.de, lawo.de, and also there is background information about Ravenna on the LC Networks page, which is ravenna.lcnetworks.com.
Okay. And I'm sure if you Google Ravenna,
absolutely, you're going to find it.
You'll find it that way too.
Perfect.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks for the invitation.
Taking that time out to be
with
us. Appreciate it.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
This is exciting because now you've got facilities that are not necessarily locked into an Axia LiveWire environment or a Lawo environment. If you need to expand with the other brand, you could do that.
as we all know, it usually works best because then you can tailor it to your application, your needs, your workflow. When you're doing exclusive stuff, then it gets a little hunky. But after seeing the demo, that is, it's not very wowing. You're right.
Oh, connected, there's audio? There's not, yeah.
RJ45 in, RJ45 out. Wow, that's nice. Okay, I can do the same thing with LiveWire. Oh, yeah, there you go. Oh, there we go. So, but you have to look at, as Mike pointed out, look at the under the hood. When he read the white paper a year ago and said, hey, this is interesting. This is wait a minute. Light bulb goes off. So I think all of us in the audience have to think the same way. Yes, it's two separate entities. Yes, it's this. Yes, it's that. But think of what you're doing and how you're doing things. And then say, these two products apply or make sense.
Gotcha.
If you're a distribution center, a huge radio network, say in Europe or even here in the States, and you have two plants, and maybe you say, you know what? The Axial Live Wire makes sense in this portion of the plant for this group of distribution channels, mm-hmm. but the Lavo solution for consoles, maybe some feature sets, make better choices here. Now you can really leverage the cost and say, you know what? Yeah, so what? It's two different plants, two different technologies, but the workflow doesn't get impacted.
Right.
So,
right.
You could have several people in this booth right now operating between two different systems, and to them, which is important, it's seamless. It's like if you're a video editor, you work on Final Cut Pro.
Yeah.
Well, you will not do very well if you go to an AVID system right away.
Right, right.
But you'll get it because you know the basics. But then all of a sudden it's like, where are the buttons? But with what I'm hearing with Axia at the LiveWire and Ravina and Lavo, it's sort of like, don't worry about it. If you're familiar with the two outside console setups, the bridge in the middle makes it just seamless.
Yeah.
That's the approach I would look at.
And what kind of brought this home for me is on Monday evening, right at the end of the day on Monday, we had a little get-together in the Telos booth. It was all of the Axia, all the LiveWire partner companies, all the automation systems, folks at Paravel that make the Rivendell system and their hardware that they make. It was the IDC satellite receiver guys, the 25/7 guys who make the profanity delay and things like that. They were in this party, but so were all the partners of Ravenna IP Audio, like Genelec. Mm-hmm. And so you get the 35... LiveWire partners and the, I don't know, 10, 15 or so Ravenna partners just to start out with. And now we're all in the same party room because we're all talking to each other with the technology and over a beer, too.
Well, you have to have the beer.
You have to have the beer.
That's traditional. But think of it. You're breaking away from the silo mentality or business models that people love to use because it's a comfort zone. So you break away from that. Now all of a sudden you got ideas opening up. And like you say, you have partners and manufacturers together. And like, wait a minute, you can do this with that? Whoa, okay, we got a common bridge. Great, let's talk.
I've got a great segue to what you just said, but first I want to remind folks that you are watching live coverage from the NAB on This Week in Radio Tech. It's our 125th episode. I'm Kirk Harnack, and I work for the folks at Telos, Omnia, and Axia. And my partner here, partner in crime, co-host, Chris Tobin, is the president over at Musicam USA. Right?
Yep. Yes, yes.
Good deal. Well, as we roll along and continue, you were talking about, hey, I can now plug this into that, my favorite this into my favorite that. So
absolutely.
what if you're a European radio station, typically as a lot of European stations have Lavo, although plenty of other ones do too, and you say, you know what, I want to try this new Omnia 11 audio processor. I want to be able to plug that into my Ravenna network. It just occurred to me, man, you're going to be able to do that pretty soon.
Absolutely.
And to find out more about the Omnia 11 processor and other such technologies, I want to introduce my boss and friend for many years, Frank Foti.
Bruce Springsteen isn't here. He talks about the boss. Actually, the boss was in Cleveland last night.
Yeah?
I wasn't there. I think he stayed over at my house because his guitar player, Steven Van Zandt, a.k.a. Silvio Dante in The Sopranos, is the godfather to my cat, Silvio Dante. So I don't know anything about Boss. Maybe Il Padrino, possibly.
Padrino.
Oh. Mike, this Balzini business.
The ring is right here. There you go.
Oh, Frank. So, Frank, the Omnia section of the Telos booth is just hopping. You've got our...
Kirk Easter was a week and a half ago. I'm sorry.
I can't get it right.
Folks, I've been here all week, And he has been tipping the waitress.
Yeah. So, Frank, tell us what's going on in your world of audio processing.
Aside from live steam railroading, Omnia processing is moving right along down the main line. And in the audio processing side of life, we're here with our latest software update for the product, which is version 1.1 software.
This is the Omni 11 we're speaking
of. Omni 11.
Yeah.
And the key item of that is Cornelius, who's the Clarence Clemens of the organization here. If you're going to call me the boss. Has done some tremendous work on the dynamics algorithms. Yours truly, in a fit of insanity, came up with a new clipping system that further reduces harmonic distortion and intermod distortion and adds some natural brightness to the sound. We've been shipping this now for about a couple of weeks, and the feedback has just been spectacular. The other item, which I guess kind of segues into a topic I think you guys want to grill me about, is we have a new standalone stereo generator known as Omnia 1 SG. And the cool benefit of this is that Omnia 1 SG has the ability to enable single sideband transmission for FM stereo should a broadcaster want to do some experimenting with that, which thus far, which has been the reason for the initiative, is to help reduce the effect of multipath sensitivity.
This has been the subject of white papers that you've been presenting, mm-hmm. and we've gotten a great feedback from some users. And on the show, on an earlier episode, we covered pretty clearly how the FM baseband works.
Right.
So that you got to start with the knowledge of that
right.
before you understand, well, what would single sideband, and you know, when I hear single sideband, when I hear that, I think of, you know, ducks talking on amateur radio.
Right.
So I'm thinking, how does this help FM stereo?
Well, the short form, so that it doesn't get too rocket science, if you will, is FM stereo that we've been, you know, that's been ubiquitous throughout the world for 51 years, uses a technique called double sideband suppressed carrier, which is how the stereo information, the O-R segment,
right.
is carried over the air.
Now, this keeps FM stereo compatible with mono radio, so you don't miss anything with a mono radio.
Right, because the mono, the L plus R,
yeah.
is transmitting the first 15 kilohertz of okay. the spectrum. And then the left minus right, or the L minus R, is transmit double sideband
yep.
based on a suppressed carrier at 38 kilohertz,
mm-hmm.
which means from 23 to 38 kilohertz is a lower sideband, carrying the same signal that's also in the 38 to 53 kilohertz range.
Right.
And what we've learned is that, you know, if there's one annoyance above all to FM radio listening throughout the world,
mm-hmm.
it's the effect of multipath,
mm-hmm.
and in some cases it is a tune out. I mean, the station will appear like it's gone away. As a matter of fact, we've put up on YouTube about a 1 minute demonstration in Boston as from a real world user I think MJX 106.7.
This is Paul Shulin's
right.
One of his stations.
Right.
Yeah.
Owned by Greater Media. And, you know, if you want to have a top drawer in engineering practice, it's the Greater Media guys.
Yeah.
And in this video, what Paul did was he used a video camera on a dashboard. And so you can see the route he's driving at a constant speed. And in the double sideband mode, the station is a tune-out. You cannot hear it at all. And then the very next day, they run the same route, same speed, except now it's in single sideband, and you hear the radio station.
And I've seen this video. We've actually talked about it. We had Paul Shulin's on this show a few weeks ago.
Okay.
And gave the URL for the video. And it almost
right.
seems like the second day they must have lopped off the top of the hill that's blocking the coverage.
Right.
It's amazing.
Right.
Now,
and by the way, just so that this is not a one-off situation.
Right.
We've been contacted by a Class A station in Fresno, California,
yeah.
Where they apparently there's a suburb of Fresno where the population has grown, a lot of retailers are there, and this station could not get their signal into this area no matter what they tried. They moved the tower, no success. Tried different antenna, no success. New transmitter, no success. I mean, the bill for this obviously is way up there. And I believe last fall, they put an Omni 11 on the air, and they figured, you know what, it doesn't cost us anything to try it. They switched
right.
on single sideband. They went through the proper authorizations to do so, which is called getting an experimental authorization from the FCC.
Okay.
And they said it was like magic. All of a sudden, the radio station was getting into a part of their service area where it belonged, and they're now reaching, you know, listeners and retailers, and they feel they're going to make more money now because they can go and sell advertising to people that could never hear the radio station before.
Now, by not transmitting on this double sideband L-R part of the FM baseband, by not transmitting the upper sideband.
Right, which is the range from 38 to 53 kilohertz.
And it's redundant information to the lower sideband.
Right.
But when FM was developed, I guess it was just convenient and easy to make a double sideband modulator.
Well, yes. And also, as you know, I know you guys have experience in the amateur radio world. Single sideband done in the analog domain, be it ICs, transistors, or tubes, was very unstable and very difficult to do. Well, the beauty of doing things in the digital domain, we can make it very stable. And the other thing, which is, which was one of the points that a few people felt was going to be a fly in the ointment, is when you pass a peak-controlled signal through a single sideband modulator, what ends up happening is you can cause overshoots. Mm. But we deal with that aspect, so there's zero overshoots, and we do it in the same manner that we manage any overshoots from low-pass filtering in the left and right domain in stereo.
Okay.
And we do it in a way that that the peak control that's required, so there are no overshoots, is also both inaudible to the audio signal as well as to the spectrum, meaning we're not causing any more harmonics to be generated.
So a question from the chat room is, does eliminating one of the sidebands increase noise since receivers are looking for some information that's not there?
No. The reason being is that we raised the level of the lower sideband by 6 dB so that in the receiver, the L plus R, L minus R decoding...
Oh, it still matches up.
It still matches up.
Okay.
And here's another thing. So that in a conventional radio that has double sideband decoding, mm-hmm. the noise floor will remain exactly the same. But wait, there's more. when there's single sideband transmission, and should the receiver only decode the single sideband, there is about a wideband noise improvement in stereo of about 4 dB. And you might say, but 4 dB doesn't sound like a lot. And again, guys, but wait, there's more. That noise improvement is not flat. It's actually tilted downwards. And the reason being is that the noise generated by the FM modulation process goes up at 6 dB per octave.
Right.
The lower sideband basically has an inverted spectrum, meaning that 15 kilohertz is residing at 23 kilohertz.
Yes, yes.
And
okay.
DC yep. is, in essence, at 38.
Yeah.
So when you de-emphasize everything, the signal-to-noise improvement at high frequencies is 10 dB. And when you think about it, what does the ear lock into to noise first? It's high frequency,
yeah.
the hiss. So the hiss drops radically.
Wow.
So there are true benefits to doing this aside from reducing multipath.
Right.
And receiver manufacturers, they're studying this whole process,
yeah.
and they feel that should things continue the way they're going, they're probably going to make a radio that'll be smart enough such that if it sees double sideband, it'll decode double sideband.
Yeah.
Should it see single sideband only, it'll close down the decoder so that there will be an improvement in signal to noise in the receiver. Bottom line, the listener wins no matter what. And if the listener wins, the broadcaster wins,
yeah.
and then the rest of us get to go along for that ride.
Man,
this is exciting. This is so exciting.
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so.
Frank, thanks for your technical work on this. I sure appreciate it. And I didn't realize about the 4 dB and then the 10 dB possible improvement with a little change in with a smart receiver.
As I said, but wait, there's more.
Chris, you've been around FM transmitters a while. This is intriguing, isn't it?
It is intriguing, and actually Frank is going to be working with a friend of mine in New York City radio station that's going to be trying out some stuff.
Hey guys, speaking of New York City, can I do a shout-out?
Sure.
Can I?
Sure.
Hang on.
He's sure.
Serving the universe from the top of the Empire State Building. WHTC C100.
Oh, the flamethrower.
I think Mr. Leonard says hello. By the way, we're going to do some of the single sideband multipath testing using Mr. Leonard's lime green Pinto.
Frank, I appreciate you coming on. Thank you so much for being here.
If I may say so,
yeah.
The work you're doing is tremendous. this is the future of broadcasting. You know, here we're, you know, working our butts off to talk to conventional broadcasters, but this is the future of broadcasting, and I'm honored to have been asked to be a part of your efforts here. Thank
come,
you very
come
much.
Come back anytime. I'd
be happy
it.
To do that.
Okay. Thanks Frank.
Guys.
Thank you, Frank.
Good luck.
Frank Foti, the CEO of the Telos Alliance. Telos on the
accident.
Yeah, he, you know. Frank also spoke at the 10th anniversary get together last night for you know, the anniversary of Linear Acoustic. Did a fabulous job. And,
well, Frank's a good storyteller.
Yes, he is.
If
yes,
you want, you know, good stories in the business, buy him a drink, sit down, make some time, you know, a couple of minutes, and you'll be surprised what you'll hear. Some good stuff. No, and that shout out that Frank did. It's funny. Just the other night, I was going through my business card holder. You know, we all have them, and I found a card. It said Frank Foti, Chief Engineer. Z100. It's the original card. It's got the Z, the lightning bolt Z that Zenith basically told Malrite, sorry, you can't use that logo anymore. Those of us in the New York City area remember the little balloons, the stickers they had.
I'm embarrassed to say that I don't know the story. I don't know who is Leonard and who is the lime green
Mr. Leonard. He was the character in the Morning Zoo.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Introduced to New York City.
I haven't listened to the Morning Zoo. Now, the announcer on that liner, was that Scott Shannon?
I don't know. I should know that, and I don't recall. He was a voice talent that you definitely heard for a long time.
Okay.
When Malrite went on the air with Z100 in 1984. 100.3.
So this FM single sideband, I guess I want to make clear that, and Frank Foti's white papers are online at omniaaudio.com. Find the white paper section. There it is. But we're not talking about the whole FM signal being single sideband. We're
talking
about that L minus R portion in the baseband.
The portion that the pilot controls.
Yeah.
Basically, I guess is the simplest way to put it.
And through DSP technology, we can, with no vestigial part left, we can get rid of the upper sideband very cleanly, and FM receivers, standard FM receivers, don't know the difference.
Right. The nice thing is, and as I mentioned earlier, I'm working with a broadcaster in New York City regarding this technology for their signal with some multipath concerns, recently moving an antenna. They're directional, so the back end of the directional array, unfortunately, has a lot of multipath.
Oh, yeah.
More so than
they
expected, but that's the way it works. The technology that Frank's talking about, because it's digital, you can, you know, be finite in certain sideband, you know, filtering. It's the same technology that's been used for audio processing now, and you can do a lot. But the one thing to bear in mind is the transmission itself, the transmission medium. Now that you have this control in your sideband, now you can go back into the transmitter and do some more tweaking, get the band, you know, the bandpass, you know, broader, check to see any AM noise, you know, that's generated by the transmission facility, the bandwidth, whether it's constricted. And I think if you really look at it, as Mike Dosch pointed out early on when he read the white paper a year ago for the audio over IP stuff and said, wait a minute, I get where they're going with this. We do the same thing. I think Frank's approach to the single sideband is the same. Step back, you know, don't immediately draw conclusions. Go, oh, I'm not gonna. This is, I gotta buy an Omnia SG1, whatever. Blah blah blah. Yeah, this is BS. Step back, reinvest time and energy, and relearn what the FM transmission's about. It is 51 years old, and understand the technology, and then take a look at the white paper. And go, wow. You know what? Even if I don't have multipath that I notice, maybe I can improve what I have already. Because what is multipath? Multiple signals. Where do multiple signals appear in delay to each other? Offices. Cars, Walkman type, like portable radios, if you will. So, you know, don't think this is just for somebody who has multipath issues that are apparent. It just blows, you know, just comes out at you. Just my, you know, my opinion.
Something that occurred to me is that, and this, our podcast is sponsored by the folks at Telos Omnia Axia, so I feel okay doing a little commercial here.
Yeah, please.
Up until this show, if you wanted to take advantage of this FM single sideband technology, you had to go buy an Omnia 11 or an Omnia 9. Right. I think the Omnia 9's got this in it too. And you know, these are high priced processors that if you got to be competitive, is what you want. But if you want this technology, this FM single sideband technology, in a less expensive processor, well, Frank just mentioned that the Omnia 1 now has a version called the Omnia 1 SG. And I honestly, I don't know what this thing costs yet. I would imagine it's probably in the $3,000 range, like the regular Omnia 1. But this would have the single sideband FM stereo generator available in it too. Oh, and I guess to get this technology, you need to use the stereo generator that's in the audio processor, that's in the Omnia. If you feed AES audio to your exciter, you're not going to be able to take advantage of this until the exciter manufacturers redesign their stereo generators.
Right. Now, remember, what you just said is not a negative.
Right.
Right off the cuff, somebody hears that, go, see? There's a problem.
Yeah. No.
Remember what I said, transmission path. Understand the blocks in the transmission path.
In my opinion, you want to use, whether you've got an Omnia or one of our competitors, you want to use the stereo generator that's in the processor if
Absolutely.
You can.
Absolutely. Actually, anyone who's done audio processing long enough knows when you put them all in one box, it makes it much easier to control what it is you're trying to do, which is control a waveform that is dynamic. If you separate everything, the interlinking between the devices then has to be even more, I'll say, pristine, more flat response in audio and whatever you do with it, just like AES, you know, or a composite signal from a stereo generator output to your exciter input. Mm-hmm. You can't just use any piece of coax. It shouldn't be just any length.
Right.
Remember,
right.
You know, all these things are like, you can induce multipath right between your stereo generator output and you input the exciter.
Yes, you can. That's
and there are people in the audience going, oh, you're nuts. No way. I said,
yes, you can.
Those of us who have been around long enough remember the analog days. Yes. And that's part of the problem.
If you have some reflections at these higher frequencies in the bass.
Absolutely.
Band,
sure. Right. Okay. So that's why I say go back to the basics, understand, you know, break it down and realize, oh, wow, the new technology, digital, you know, DSPs, I'll call it, and the philosophy of how we've done stuff, you bring the two together, and what Frank's talking about makes total sense. Now, you know, you definitely want to test it and make sure it's, you know, work for your application. You may find you have a transmitter that's inducing issues that you didn't know existed before.
Oh, yeah, especially synchronous AM noise.
Synchronous
issues.
AM noise, right, which is a byproduct of the transmission technology. It's not because it's digital, not because it's analog. That is the way it works.
Right.
You're oscillating a signal and creating a modulating signal, that's how it works.
You know, we're gonna do another episode on TWiRT about these ways that you can subtly or not so subtly mess up an FM signal.
Oh, absolutely.
By mistuning the transmitter, by not having the antenna right. We're gonna get Gary Minker on.
Oh, he's, Gary Minker.
Yeah, he does this mostly for television, but for FM.
Yeah,
too.
But see, even for television, it applies for FM.
Sure.
You know, FM and television transmission methods are very similar.
Yeah.
The only difference is the bandwidth is a little, you know, wider. Yeah. Really.
A moment ago, you gave me another great segue opportunity. Ooh. You used the word pristine in a sentence. So I'm going to say, and speaking of pristine.
Drum roll.
We have George Thomas.
Yeah, good morning.
Hi, George.
Kirk, Chris. Good
morning.
To see y'all.
You are, those of you who watch the TWiT network, you know that George is absolutely no stranger here. In fact, George has brought his soldering iron, and while we're talking, he's going to be putting together a Heathkit color television.
Well, I had a problem with that. They checked me at the door, and they wouldn't let me in because I had lead solder.
So. Nothing like the smell of lead solder. So, in fact, are you using lead-free solder now?
No.
Or no, you're still using lead solder.
I still use lead.
Yeah.
I'm from the old school, and it just seems to work better. But and it's still legal here in the U.S. for us to, you know, hobbyists and all to use it. So.
Yeah. Well, good to see you. And George, you are on the Ham Nation show.
Yeah.
You do a lot of teaching of basic electronic techniques.
Yeah. Build little projects or discuss different theories or show some software. Anything, you know, to help the hobbyists build projects and to get more people involved in that kind of thing. Because I think it's slipped away over the years. People don't build as much as they used to.
Right.
And now, fortunately, to the maker movement coming along, I think that's got people, you know, interested again.
Yeah, you're right. Maker Magazine and their websites and the fair, maker fairs that they have gets folks interested in not only electronics but in other kinds of build-it-yourself ideas.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Now, we alluded to this word pristine, and hey, I knew you before you were associated with this company, Pristine, but tell me what Pristine does.
Well, Pristine is one of the original radio station automation companies. We produce automation systems and live assist systems for radio stations to use to put all their music on hard drive and the commercials and everything and either have a jock sit there and play them out or automate it or work with some of the satellite formats. And, you know, that technology has changed some over the years, but Kirk, you know, we go back in radio, and I'm sure Chris does too, where it seems like we spent half our life maintaining tape machines.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, that would be true.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, you know, when this technology came along, we started getting good quality sound cards, I got interested right away, you know, and boy, I suspect the new guys don't know, you know, what they're missing by not having to work on all those tape machines, because, you know, that was the majority of the time I spent, you know, was taking care of cart machines and reel-to-reels.
You've replaced a lot of tape heads.
Yep.
And tape guides, probably.
Yeah. Done a lot of demagnetizing.
Oh, yeah.
There's probably folks that don't even know what that
is. Demagnetizing?
Hey,
How
many folks in our audience know what it is if I were to do something like this and do this?
Yep.
Degaussing.
What is that? And you know what? All the old guys, if you're 50 or older, you know what I was doing right then. Except you wouldn't do it to a coffee cup and a cell phone.
Right, but, yeah. No,
those are just props.
You know the motion.
You know the motion.
But, you know, the business has really changed over the years. Axia, you know, your new technology is really changing the way things are done in the studio. Well, and
now, with a pristine, you mentioned sound cards earlier, but Pristine is one of our partner companies.
Yeah.
You can put an IP driver in the computer that's running Pristine and never turn this audio back into analog audio or AES. It goes out as packets.
Yeah, and, you know, if you've got an Autel transmitter, it just stays digital all on through.
Yeah, that's right.
Absolutely.
They have a live wire input there. Cool.
Yeah.
And apparently soon you'll be able to run that audio into a Ravenna audio into a Lavo audio console too.
Yeah.
Well, that George, you're also an amateur radio operator, which is why you're on the Ham Nation show.
Yeah.
Tell me a bit about Bob Heil's Ham Nation show yesterday, and you were on here, and I got to be on here for a while. What is the interactivity between your amateur radio hobby and your professional life as an engineer?
Well, they kind of run parallel, and I see Chris just at his Kenwood HT up there on the desk.
I just put a prop out.
Boy, that looks nice. That's smaller than the little Ocean I have.
It's the Kenwood.
Which one is that?
What do you call it? THF6.
Yeah.
Tri-bander.
Well, that's nice.
Not TriCaster.
I got into radio in 72 as a disc jockey while I was in high school, like a lot of us did.
Yeah, yeah.
And I worked there through high school and college. And when I got out, I went into engineering and worked in television for about 5 years. And, you know, my roots were in radio, so I went back. And I was fortunate to be the chief engineer for what's now the Clear Channel Cluster in Jackson, Mississippi for about 12 years. And that's while I was there is when I got fed up with the tape machines and started computer programming and working on this, automation project. But, I wasn't a ham. I didn't get a ham license back in the 70s. A friend of mine lent me his Smith Code Course record, but he couldn't find the book, you know, as I mentioned yesterday. So I never learned the code.
You don't have to now. I never learned Morse code either.
I didn't either. When was it? 91, I think they dropped the code for the technician license. So the first weekend, you know, after they dropped it, I went and took the test and got a technician. And I stayed a tech for years, actually, until they dropped the code for all class licenses. And, at that point, I was no longer working at a radio station every day, and I wasn't getting the minimum daily requirement of RF in my diet. So I upgraded to extra and got on the HF bands. And Kirk, that's a lot of fun. You're going to enjoy it.
See, I've got the license now and I've got the equipment. I just got to get that antenna hung up and get over my fear of talking on the radio.
Yeah. Just listen. Like we were telling yesterday, just listen around a little bit and you'll find some people that you share a common interest in and where you want to talk, and then you'll find some folks that you definitely don't want to follow up with because some groups are closed. You know, they only have their people they like to talk to, and you might have some differing political views and such, but overall, you'll find most everyone is friendly on there and welcome you right in.
We're talking to George Thomas here on This Week in Radio Tech. We are live this time. at the National Association of Broadcasters 2012 Convention Expo Brouhaha, and this is our 125th episode on This Week in Radio Tech on the TWiT.tv network. Lots of ways to subscribe to this podcast and others on the TWiT network, and the best way to find out about all that is to make sure you stop by the TWiT.tv website. If you're watching this, you're probably already there, but I want to remind you that there's great ways to make sure you automatically get the podcast that you want. If you can't watch live or listen live, you can certainly set up your iTunes or other MP3 type playout system software to receive by the iTunes Store, by RSS feeds. There's lots of availability to subscribe to the podcast, and it's a great way to make sure you automatically get them. Hey, whenever I sync up my iPod, I've got one in the car, I've got an iPad, and I've got also a little iPod I carry with me on the planes. So whether I'm in the car or flying through the air, I have all the latest podcasts that I'm interested in from the TWiT network, like Security Now and This Week in Google, and of course the TWiT podcast itself, and of course this one, This Week in Radio Tech. Our show is sponsored by my friends at Telos Omnia and Axia, and we're doing a special two-hour version of This Week in Radio Tech live from NAB. We've got another hour to go. Hey, Chris Tobin, I got a question for you. Do you ever go back and listen to or watch our own show? Because I don't.
I have not, but I've had the pleasure of many of our audience telling me they enjoy them.
Yeah, well
this show I had several folks come up to me and say thank you very much for some of the topics.
Not a matter of enjoyment, but man, when I go back and if I watch a few minutes of a show that we did or listen, I pick myself apart so badly. Like, why did I say that? Oh, that was dumb.
Yeah, no, I've had friends in radio and television who told me, you don't need to go back. If you go back, you'll be self-conscious, and all of a sudden you'll change. It's just, if you're successful, and when you're successful, what you do, it rolls off. It's whether it's on the microphone or in front of a camera. Oh. You need to go back and look at it. A friend of mine once told me, he goes, you've got issues. So I don't look back. I look forward. I just continue forward.
Coming up in a few minutes, our next guest is going to be Chris Shearer, but right now we're talking to George Thomas. Tell us a little bit about what Pristine Systems is doing here lately. You're an automation supplier to radio stations. What are some of the cool things you guys have come up with?
Well, we've just reworked our automation product entirely. We have a new product now called Control Room 7 that uses the latest technologies. It's designed to run under Windows 7 and soon Windows 8. And we're using the latest .NET frameworks. We're using Audio Sciences ASX platform, which gives us some additional things that we can do with the audio than we could be before. We can time stretch items now very easily. So say, you know how hard it is to get somebody to nail down a 30-second or a 60-second spot?
Right, right.
And you've got to do that if you're working with a satellite format. Well, now we can shrink or stretch that up to 20% to make those spot sets nail it exactly,
so
coming back to the net.
If a politician talks for 72 seconds on his spots, on a spot, you can run that. You can make that happen in 60 seconds.
Yeah, he'll talk pretty fast.
Yeah, he will.
Yeah, that's it.
He will.
Yeah.
George, I appreciate you being with us very, very much. Thank you for stopping by, and I would imagine we're going to see you tonight at the ham reception.
Oh, I will be there, and we'll stop by the Telos Axia booth and Omnia later today. Don't you have the reception going on over there at 5?
Oh, yeah, that's right.
The unofficial one.
Thanks for mentioning that. We have the TWiRT meetup at 5 o'clock today at the Telos booth in the Central Hall.
Good to see you, Kirk. Chris, I really enjoy the show. I do go back and watch them.
Well, that's okay. You're allowed to.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks, George.
All right. Thanks.
Thank you, George. Wow. I forgot all about this TWiRT reception. Bob Holowenko, who's been our guest on a show, and he's an avid fan, and he was here yesterday. He had to run to the airport today, though. Bob said, Kirk, we ought to do a TWiRT meetup. And I've been so busy the last few weeks. Bob actually encouraged me to figure out where to do it. And instead of going to a bar or something like that, I said, man, let's just go to the Telos booth. We've got beverages there, and we can feed a few people. And
that works.
And it makes the booth traffic look really good. So.
And the booth has that spacely sprocket look, so I like it.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah. Gee. We'll get a look at that. Actually, we're going to be doing some interviews in a number of different booths.
Right.
And they'll be played on some shows tomorrow. here on the TWiT network.
Oh, that's the plan. Gotcha.
Yeah, I thought it was all live, and thank goodness I was wrong. yeah, Lin Fu set me straight on that. Yeah, I thought, oh, man, I got a big day today. It's not as harried as I thought it was going to be. That's right.
We'll take care of it in post.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, my goodness. All right, next on This Week in Radio Tech during our 2012 NAB coverage, we've got a guy that I've known for years, and he's encouraged me to do some writing, and I appreciate that very much. He's also just a terrific proofreader and editor, and he is the editor, actually, of Radio Magazine, and something that you can check out online pretty easily. It's my friend and your friend, Chris Scherer. Hello, Chris.
Hi, guys. How are you?
I'm terrific. How are you?
All right.
Now, you have the benefit of this wonderful, melodious bass voice without all the grub, without all the from talking for several days straight.
And I've never smoked.
Well, there you go. Never have I.
And I don't drink heavily.
Oh.
Heavily.
Heavily.
Although I thought about starting. I'll let you know how it goes when we're done here.
Let us know what you decide to smoke.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Chris, tell us about what you do at Radio Mag. I think a lot of folks know, but it's important that everybody we're on the same page.
Sure. Radio Magazine has been around since 1994. It's a spinoff of another broadcast publication at that time. We're part of the New Bay Media Group of publications, and I've been in the position since 1997, so I'm coming up on my 15th year in this job. Before that, as you know, both of you know, I was also a radio station engineer. Last set of call letters under my belt were WMMS and WHK in Cleveland.
Wow, yeah.
Which
yeah.
I share with your co-workers, both Steve Church and Frank Foti, are former engineers of those stations. And that's a little bit of my background and where I got. So as far as Radio Magazine goes, it's a technology-focused publication. Our typical reader is a radio station engineer, although we do move up through the management ranks as well, so some general managers, technology managers. And comes out every month. We also post everything online with additional content, some news, and other features as well.
I think your online content is fabulous, and a lot of times I use it for show prep for This Week in Radio Tech.
Get some ideas and
things to talk about. When we do quote something from it, we always mention the URL and tell people where to go. Why don't you tell where people want to go online?
If
they
want
to do
right, Radio Magazine is at radiomagonline.com.
Okay.
A little long, but it's pretty straightforward.
So, well, if you bookmark it, then you'll have it.
Exactly. Yeah. Bookmark it once, you'll be there forever. Of course, we're also on Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn with Radio Mag,
yep.
Radio Magazine, I should say, as the hook for both Facebook and Twitter, and the typical cryptic group number for LinkedIn because they haven't quite figured that out yet.
Oh, yeah.
Well, why don't you show us the front of a couple of magazines?
Sure. Last two issues. This was our April issue. In fact, every now and then, where's my camera? Hey,
it's
there
the
it is.
We just got to tilt it down a little bit.
There we go. And I'll pull it up and block my face.
I haven't gotten this issue yet.
That was mailed just before the show.
Okay.
It probably showed up the day you left. Well, you
okay.
get here early because you're an exhibitor, of course.
Yeah. Can I see it?
Sure, certainly.
Awesome.
In fact, it's kind of funny. I mean, every now and then, that's a friend of mine, actually. That happens to be a gentleman named Kirk Chestnut, works at Intercom.
Oh, that's Kirk
Radio
Chestnut. Yeah.
In Kansas City.
Yeah, you know, half the time when I type in my own name into something in my computer, up pops Kirk Chestnut's name.
Fortunately, I have great relationships with the stations in Kansas City, and Intercom,
sure.
and
yeah.
Cumulus, and the Wilk stations let me take photos and use them as guinea pigs once in a while, so that's always good to know. The previous cover happened to also be in Kansas City. It happened to be the Kansas City Chiefs is broadcasting its games in surround.
Oh, really?
And Cumulus is also doing with the Atlanta Hawks.
Yep.
And another team that slips my mind at this moment, but that's just some of the focus that we do. So,
all right, so let's talk about this show. You go to all the press events, and it's your job to keep up on what's happening.
Right.
What are some of the things you're excited about?
Well, part of that, of course, on an ongoing basis, yes, I have to try to see every exhibitor and go to every press conference, and it really gets harrowing.
yeah.
And, you know, Monday is really a stressful day. Now that we're on Wednesday, I feel a lot more relaxed because I've gotten a lot of things taken care of, so it feels a lot better at this point. One of the big things we do with Radio Magazine at the show, as we've done since 1985, and yes, if you do the math, the magazine launched in 94, but it was part of the previous publication we were part of, started an awards program in 1985 called The Pick Hits.
Yeah.
And, oh, I brought another visual. Ta-da! So this afternoon on the show floor, these placards will be appearing Pick Hits panelists are a group of radio engineers.
Did this product win this year?
That's our little radio guy. No, he's not. He's a winner, but he's not a winning product.
Okay. But then, so right now it's still under wraps who the winners
still
are.
Under wraps because they have the panel hasn't met. The panel will meet this afternoon.
That's right.
And the panelists go around independently and anonymously making their selections. They pretty much visit the show as they normally would.
Yeah.
And they have a range of interests. So, you know, some guys are studio, some guys are transmitter, some guys are IT, some guys are all. We have a couple guys and a, you know, small market guy. We have a corporate engineering level. I try to vary the composition of the panel. Mm-hmm. Each year, and I try to change them up so it's not the same people every year. But they go about, they make their selections, and like I said, we'll gather this afternoon, and they'll make a selection of the top 20 new products from the convention.
Do you give those awards out then to the winners today?
Yes. Once the meeting is over, I do a little bit of show prep, if you will, and then I'll hit the show floor and hopefully try to get all 20 awarded, if you will, before the show floor closes at 6 o'clock.
When your panelists are looking for products to give this award to, what are they looking for?
They're looking, obviously, as I said, something new at the show. So it's not been introduced before. Basically, okay. If it was not shown before, so we typically try to say that it was invented the day after NAB in 2011, right?
Yeah.
Or after that. So new at the show. We do ask that it's a product that's going to be shipping by the end of the calendar year. And we take the manufacturer's word for it. So occasionally something comes in that is maybe a little more than vaporware. I don't want to go that far. We can usually sniff that kind of thing out.
Yeah.
It fits a need in radio. It's, you know, something we need. It's not just a nifty gadget that really doesn't do anything for you. And, of course, priced affordably, because the greatest product in the world is really worthless if it's $20 bazillion.
Wow.
Is the identity of your panelists ever known?
After the fact,
after
yes.
After the fact. Have you ever done that?
No, I have not.
No, Chris has not. Did you do it in the earlier days?
I did, yeah.
I thought you did, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, before your current employer stint. When you were a contract
engineer.
Oh, I
couldn't
engineer.
Do it now. Yeah, right. I couldn't do it. But when I was a self-employed contract engineer, in fact, when I worked for Scott Studios, I couldn't do it. But when I was the engineer for Delta Radio in Mississippi, and even prior to that as an independent contract engineer.
In fact, I think you and I served on the panel together a couple of years.
Yeah,
back
we did,
in the.
Yeah. I was always amazed at I mean, I have a few proposed items for pick hits. I was always amazed at, wow, where'd you find that?
Yeah. That's, and again, part of that, I will give credit to the panelists. They do a really good job of getting all around the floor, not just focused on the radio audio hall part. There will be a guy who will come up with the 25-cent widget, and everybody's, you know, their eyes and ears all perk up. Oh, where'd you find that type thing?
Yeah.
And, of course, then you get the guy who has the multi-million dollar type product. But you know what? If it works and it fits and it makes sense, by all means, it's considered.
So in an overview of what you see at this show, and because you're in the industry writing about things every month, which means you're writing nearly every day, gathering stuff, are there any trends that you're seeing that maybe you hadn't realized last year or the year before? Anything that's kind of popped into your head this is going to be something, or, you know, that's just not going to be anything?
Right. In the past year, maybe not so much. If you had asked, say over the past 10 years, I mean, IP, the fact that IP is just omnipresent, I don't think any of us really, well, I can't say any of us. Some of your earlier guests did, obviously. I was referring to Mike Dosch and Lawo and so on.
They were sure hoping it would go.
They were
go
right. Well. They were banking on it, and it worked out really well. But you know, that's obviously something that you can't get away from. In fact, that's modified the skill set of today's engineer, radio engineer especially.
Oh yes.
It's great that you got to know audio and you got to know RF and all the magic in between, but you also need to know a lot about IT. So
I'm guessing Kirk Chestnut is a good example of somebody who's just gotten IP skills, because that's what it takes now to be a good engineer.
And that's even reflected in another hat that I wear in my activities with the Society of Broadcast Engineers. I'll give them a quick little hit. Been almost 15 years ago, if I recall, the Society introduced a certification level, the Certified Broadcast Networking Technologist, CBNT, which I hold. But this year, we've launched sort of the next step up for that, which is the Certified Broadcast Networking Engineer, which, like a lot of our Core 4 certification levels, the CBNE carries a 5-year service requirement. So if you've been working in broadcast media and IT for 5 years, you've met the eligibility requirements to take the exam and to sit for the test.
So you have to have the eligibility requirements and pass the test before you get the CBA.
Correct.
Yeah.
Right. Wow. First tests will be offered in the, I believe, the June exam window. So,
okay.
But you can go up to the SBE booth, which is just upstairs and outside the South Hall here, and sign up to take the next exam.
You've been pretty active in promoting education through SBE.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Why is that? Why are you passionate about that?
Well, we need the education to do our jobs, and where do we get it? Broadcasting being a rather focused industry, there are a lot of unique elements involved. And you can certainly get broad education, and electronics and general IT and general RF principles certainly apply, and they'll get you there. But a lot of times, many engineers have pretty much picked up what they have on the fly, on the job. And that's obviously a great way to do it, get your hands right in there and get dirty doing it. You might make a few mistakes, and hopefully they're not too severe or deadly. We do it with a magazine as well. That's kind of the focus we've always had, is everything we write about, we do so in an attempt to help the engineer do his job better. And the SBE has sort of picked up on that as well by realizing there's kind of a bit of a void in some of the specialized educational efforts, and therefore the Education Committee and a lot of its work with SBE University and some of the other projects they've started, talking about AM directionals and IT in the broadcast environment and general broadcast maintenance. In fact, I think one of your later guests has contributed to that effort as well, with John Bisset.
Yes, so. On his way up here, yeah. Cool. Chris, what you got for Scherer?
Along the lines of education, how over the years have you seen the demographics, we'll call it, change in the engineering society? I know. I can speak for New York City in that region. I know it's changed and how it's gone. But you know, as you pointed out, those of us who've been around long enough have done a lot of stuff, and you learned on the job. You did this, and if you made mistakes, so be it. And nowadays, you make a mistake, and the technologies that we have at our fingertips, it's somewhat more dramatic. Have you seen a younger audience still coming in? A younger crowd?
Not so much. I don't have statistics off the top of my head for SBE membership.
I'm not saying membership, just in general, when you've traveled around and talked to people, because I've noticed some interesting shifts, that's why.
It seems the general average age of the broadcast engineer continues to grow, get older, I should say.
Okay.
I do see some younger people coming in. I know the NAB actually has a program of getting some college students and internships going. In fact, the SBE has now launched a mentoring program with that same effort in mind to try to get some younger people in, because as I've said, if you look at sort of a broad cross-section, the average age of the broadcast engineer, not just radio, continues to increase as the years go by.
Right.
We're just not attracting the younger audience as perhaps we used to. But you know, when I say when we used to, radio and TV were kind of the only games in town.
Right.
Now, you know, you can sit around in your socks and code your brains off at home and do all sorts of interesting things.
Yeah, absolutely. The young guys seem to be on all the other TWiT shows.
Yeah. We definitely have the gray hair factor going for us, don't we?
Yeah, we do. Chris, we're out of time, and I want to thank you so much for stopping by and enlightening us as to what you're doing. And, hey, if Radio Mag Online, or you can get your subscription if you're in the industry. Is that how it works?
Yep. There's a link right on the front page there to subscribe, and by all means, click that link. You can also, the New Bay Media booth is in the Central Hall. We also have some magazines in the booths out in front of the Central Hall as well.
Oh, cool. I will stop by.
Very good.
And I'll look in my mailbox when I get home.
Thank you.
All right. Thank
Thanks,
you, Chris.
Chris.
Take care. Hey, you know what? Coming up on tomorrow, you'll be able to watch the TWiT Network, and we're going to have a lot of interviews that I'm going to do today.
Right.
And some of the people we'll be talking to I got some antenna man. When we do our usual show on Wednesday nights, we really can't show you or bring for show and tell a big honking antenna.
That doesn't work well.
No. So we're going to be going to the booths of Cachefly Labs.
Excellent.
Talk to Bob Surrett, great guy. We're also going to JamPro.
Excellent.
And we're going to ERI. Now, we're doing that today, but you'll be able to watch those interviews tomorrow here on the TWiT Network. So if you've ever wanted to, you know, get up close and personal, at least on a video level, with an FM or a UHF or VHF antenna, they're big.
They're very big. Think of the wavelength of FM, about 5 feet. So
yeah.
I once caught an antenna this big. For those of you who are movie buffs,
we're also going to be visiting with ENCO. Gene Novacek there at ENCO. Orban, we're going to go to the Orban booth and talk to Greg Oganowski.
Oh, yeah.
And also, I don't think Bob is there. I haven't seen Bob yet, but if he's there, we'll talk to him. Oh, Bill and Kim Sachs.
Oh, yes,
are
yes.
in the Orban booth, and they're just always a riot.
Yes.
Yeah.
I talked to Bill and Kim yesterday.
Also, Nautel. Now, we've had a couple of guys from Nautel on the show, but we're going to get to show you a transmitter.
Yes.
Tomorrow.
Worth looking at.
Yeah. Yeah.
Worth watching.
And nowadays, you know, it used to be for entertainment purposes, transmitters had a window with glowing tubes behind the window. What do they have for entertainment purposes now?
Monitor, LCD screen.
LCD
and you can
screen.
Watch the little graphics move.
Exactly.
Or
exactly.
If you really are ambitious and the transmitter manufacturer is really willing, feed it into a dummy load and ask them to pop the door.
Woo.
Oh, that's right. It's a low voltage cutout.
That doesn't do anything. No.
That doesn't do anything either. That was always fun. Get a nice spark out of the back.
You know, on modern transmitters, I guess there's only two places to hurt yourself, the AC input and the RF output. And all the rest of it.
All the modules, no, if you look at the currents, there's like you know, several hundred amps.
I guess you could do some welding there.
Yes, you can.
Hey, we're moving right along. You're watching live coverage, unless you're watching this recorded, from NAB 2012. My name is Kirk Harnack. I'm here with Christopher Tobin, the best-dressed engineer in radio. And and our show is brought to you by Telos, Omni, and Axia. Very glad to have them sponsoring This Week in Radio Tech. Now, we've got a couple of guests that I'm just delighted have been able to show up here on our stage. We have Tom Hartnett. Now, Tom, you've been on the show before.
I have.
But yeah. I wasn't there. I was traveling.
That's right. Tom Ray did a great job, though, and we had an opportunity to introduce some of our cool stuff.
And I see you brought something with you. Tom Hartnett is from Comrex.
Right. I'm the technical director of Comrex.
Oh, you can eat the microphone. It works better if you eat it. Yeah.
How's that?
That's better.
All right. I'm the tech director of Comrex. I've been with them since as long as I can remember, and I'm responsible for all new product design and basically everything technical in the company. So.
Wow. And you guys have come out with some awesome products in the last few years.
Thank you.
Every year or two, you come out with something like,
it's nice to hear because we work awfully hard on them.
Well, and nice to hear from your competitor, too.
Yeah.
You guys do a great job.
That makes it extra special.
And also with us is John. And John, is it Bisset or Bisset?
You got it right. It's Bisset.
All right.
And you wanted to see a transmitter. We've got one right
here. You brought one.
We brought one under your arm. That's how light it is. So it's a 2-kilowatt transmitter, FM transmitter, Kirk. So, Elenos manufactures these. We manufacture transmitters from 100 watts up to 30 kilowatts. And they're fantastic rigs. They really are.
We've got a few subjects to cover here in just a few minutes. I want to introduce John, first of all, as someone who has helped the industry tremendously through his writing. John has put together for years a workbench kind of article. Tell
us
about your writing and gathering and your motivation to help out other engineers through technical tips.
Sure, Kirk. That's great. The column is called Workbench. It's in Radio World, and past columns are archived. So you go to www.rwonline.com and look under the columns, and you'll see Workbench. It's a tech tips type of column that as I've traveled around selling transmitters and working for manufacturers, I've encountered a lot of engineers that have come up with some unique ways to save money, unique ways to do things, and that's what the column is all about, is sharing these tips with engineers and helping them do their job more effectively.
Probably once in a while you run across a tip of how not to do something.
Quite a lot. I've got a tip of or a picture, I should say, of a mouse inside a transmitter poking his head up. You were talking about solid state and the voltages.
Mm-hmm.
He was inside the power supply and got across the power supply and got electrocuted, but not before he stuck his head out of the little top of the power supply. So, you see some really bizarre things, that's for sure.
Nothing.
Snakes in transmitters,
you
know, you name it.
Not many smells in the world like burned, rotting mouse.
No, roasted.
Roasted.
Roasted real
tastes
good.
Just like chicken, right?
And I love reading your articles because well, I still do some transmitter work at my own stations, but when I was doing that full time, I'll tell you what, there is no better way to find a problem before it happens or find the problem that is happening than to open up the transmitter and clean it.
Absolutely.
You have to look at everything to clean it.
You can spot a lot of problems if wires are loose or components are stressed and they're discolored. You can see what's going to happen before it actually happens. So works out well.
Oh, I guess that bulge in the capacitor is not a good thing.
Absolutely, no. Or oil leaking out of
it. Oh, the oil, yes, I've had both.
The PCB oil.
Yes, I've had that too.
So, yes. RWOnline.com. We reference RWOnline on our show quite a bit also because that's our crib sheet for our news. You know, we get it from there and from Radio Mag. So your Workbench past articles are all there.
Be good.
Okay. And we're going to get back to the transmitter in just a moment. Let's turn our attention back over to Tom Hartnett. And you brought something with you for a little show and tell.
Well, you know, our product line falls pretty much into two categories. We've been working very hard for a lot of years at trying to help a radio broadcaster do remotes. Yeah. And that's with little products like this guy, mm-hmm. who's designed to do IP-type remotes over things like 3G, 4G, Wi-Fi, DSL, things like that.
Right.
Very, very popular product. The other side of our business has been the telephone interface business with the acquisition of the Gettner products back in 2002. We've introduced another talk show system. And what I'd like to talk about a little is a system that we have now that blends those two efforts.
Okay.
It's kind of my personal campaign to try to rid as much telephone audio from the radio as possible.
Yes, yes.
It's my belief that as soon as you have a telephone on the air, especially if it's a cell phone, for more than 30 seconds, that listener is hovering over the scan
button.
Absolutely,
absolutely.
And nobody wants that.
Yep.
Absolutely.
It's interesting. We work for competing companies, and we have the same goal for our stations and our customers.
Exactly. Yeah. And for our listeners, too.
Listeners, yeah.
Absolutely. So as part of this campaign, we introduced last year a telephone talk show system based on voice over IP that will actually allow wideband phone calls to be taken on the air.
Yeah.
Okay, so you can now have your quarterback or your professional lawyer expert or your doctor call in on a wideband app or a wideband hard phone, mm-hmm. and take that call and use it just like a regular phone line. Now, what we've done this year is taken the second step of that, because the apps and the hard phones that are used on the caller end are incredibly complicated. And unless you have an engineer there to help them set it up, it really can't be done.
No.
So what we're introducing this year is an app that's now available on both the iTunes and the Android Play Store, as it's called now.
Yeah.
We call it VIP Quick Connect. And essentially, what it does is, when the user downloads it, it gets a nice little list of radio stations. And this is a living list that is... just for the asking, we'll put you in this list.
Okay.
But along with your name and your logo, we'll also hide away all of that complicated SIP information,
yes.
all the server, yep. the SIP name, everything else that's needed to make that connection. So the user just has to go in, say WXYZ told them to download this app, they just have to find it on the list. And once they do that, the app essentially now becomes locked to that station.
Ah, okay.
So every other time it gets booted, it's just this station's branded app.
Yeah.
And it has one button on it.
Yeah.
Which is call station wideband.
That's cool.
Okay.
That's great.
So that's something that you could even promote on the air for listeners.
Sure. Get our app. When you call in, you're going to sound great.
And we're going to take you first if you call in on our app.
Hey.
Oh, yeah.
Smart.
The sounding great part doesn't matter to the listener. The fact they get in first, they have direct access to the studio.
Right. So we now have a system where we got the apps out there. The system also handles Skype calls. And I know that's important to you because you use that every day on your system. And you know how good that sounds. So what we can see eventually is a talk show where there are no telephones on the air.
Yeah.
And that's what I'd love to hear.
Yeah. So what now in that app, so what codec are people getting when they're making that call?
At this point, we're running G722.
Right, which is a huge improvement. I mean, it's funny.
Yeah.
These phone companies are calling that HD voice.
Right.
Right?
Exactly.
And
to
broadcasters, we're going, really? That's HD voice, G722?
Well, let's see. Put yourself in their position from the telecom side.
Uh-huh.
Anything above 3K is HD.
Oh, yes. Right. And so,
or 2.5, depending where you are in the world.
It's interesting, these two different mindsets about G722. As broadcasters, we think it's the plan B, the plan C, the last resort.
Yeah.
But
if
for telephony, it's like, wow, it's the gold standard.
It also has, inherently, is very low delay.
Yes.
And also for application developers, there's no licensing. It's all free out there.
Exactly.
So it's it's a no-brainer.
Yep.
But we're also migrating over eventually to a codec called ISAC,
yes.
which is a Google-based product,
yeah.
which basically delivers equivalent quality in about half the bit rate.
Oh, goodness.
So the goal there is to enhance stability by using less bandwidth.
So, again, this app is something that a radio station would deploy and promote to its listeners. Not necessarily, I mean, a reporter could use it too.
We're actually deploying it.
Yeah.
It's the Comrex app that's up there.
Yeah.
They just have to point the people to it and then tell them to go find their station on the list. It then becomes their app.
Yeah. And could a listener change that station?
Yes, he could.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not locked permanently. You can go back in there and make the decision over again.
Very cool. Now, you guys are in the Central Hall.
Yes.
And, in fact, we're going to come interview you in just a little while, and it'll be played back tomorrow, it turns out.
That's what I'm told.
Good deal.
Yep.
Good deal. Tom, thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
Appreciate it so much. And, Mr. Bisset, you have a transmitter.
Absolutely.
You pirate.
That's for sure.
Is that RFR compliant?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Our exposure time here has exceeded 6 minutes.
There you go. It's a 2-kilowatt rig, and we use the same chassis from 100 up to 2 kilowatts. But we also have the same compact style in 3 kilowatts, 5 kilowatts, and then we stack them to get up to the 30-kilowatt power level.
Now, does that have the exciter in it as well?
The exciter is built into it.
Right.
The power supply is something that Elenos built. It's an industrialized switching power supply.
Right.
But it's built to our specifications, so we're not depending on someone else building a power supply and cutting corners on the parts and having it blow up.
Right.
It's something that is very, very stable.
So in a transmitter, that's the 2-kilowatt version.
This is 2 kilowatts.
So what voltage and amperage does that power supply have to supply to the finals to get 2 kilowatts of RF out of there?
We're looking at a couple of hundred volts, and the basic input AC is essentially 220, 240 going in. And the actual current draw on the MOSFETs depends on the power level.
Sure.
This transmitter is 74% efficient.
Okay.
So one of the things, yes, it's really, especially when you're looking at 50% on some transmitters.
Yeah.
What this company, Elenos, has done in Italy, electrical costs have been very expensive there. And we're starting to see that same problem here now in the United States. So engineers are very interested in saving money. Not only are they saving money on the electrical costs, but because the transmitter operates so efficiently, there's hardly any heat coming out of the transmitter.
Oh,
no more heating your transmitter site with the transmitter.
How much? What are the BTUs coming out of that?
Well, let's see. If it's 74% AC to RF, that'd be 26% is heat,
right.
And 26% of a little over 2,000. You're looking at 500 watts of heat coming out?
If even that.
If that.
So it's less than a PC server, less than a server.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
We have an operating 5-kilowatt transmitter in our booth, and you can put your hand to the back of it and feel the air coming out. You're talking about stress tests. We have a stress test for this transmitter where we disconnect the output so it's operating into an open load. Where we have a hole in the transmission line where we can stick a screwdriver in and get the spark that you were talking about. Chris.
This is in the booth?
Well, when you
this
go to transmitter training, that's what they do. You remember those? This is Quincy.
Absolutely, that's right. And just to show you that the transmitter will protect itself, what it does is it shuts down, then it sits there and it looks at the situation. If the problem is gone, then it will reapply power. If the problem is maintained, then it will stay off. So it protects itself from destruction if it doesn't have a load or if there's a short circuit.
Wow. That technology in these modern solid-state transmitters. And the guys at Elenos, I have been I've been familiar with these guys for a bunch of NABs now, maybe 20 years worth, because I was always intrigued by their industrial design. Beautiful. Beautiful stuff.
Yeah, it's very nice.
I've got to tell you, the company is located in Ferrara. Mm-hmm. Does that ring a bell? Ferrari. It's where the Ferraris are built. So you can see some of the design there. Something else that they've done, and we've got a video of this, the entire board is encapsulated with a lacquer, and we have a technician spraying water into an operating 5-kilowatt transmitter and it stays on the air.
That's what we do at our station.
Yeah. So for corrosion-ish instances, problems with corrosion, or in a high humidity environment.
A tropical environment that takes care of that.
So they've come up with some very unique things. Kirk, one last thing I'll tell you real quickly that they've got that, that you'll like this because you've done this before. We have an N+1 system. N+1 is a backup transmitter system that gives you a backup transmitter for multiple other transmitters that are at a site.
Right.
If you've
got
multiple sites.
Yeah.
The thing that makes ours so different, we provide the cabling to anyone else's transmitter. So we'd like you to have an N+1 with all Alenos equipment, but if you've got other brands, we can give you the cable that plugs directly into those other brand of transmitter to make the switching system work.
Great.
So,
do you have
no
them?
More soldering the little
right,
pins
right,
and
right,
all
right.
that,
yeah.
you know?
So, my Marconi transmitter will be my +1. And we'll get the cable.
Wait a minute, that's
very
a spark
good.
Gap.
That's right.
By the way, Marconi was from Bologna, which is right next door to Ferrara.
Uh-huh.
So we've got a lot of radio history in Italy, and we've opened up a U.S. office now in Miami with full service, full parts, spare parts, and soon to have manufacturing there as well.
You're associated with the folks at 305 Broadcast, is that right?
That's correct. 305 and Alenos. Alenos owns half of 305, so there's a ownership there. But the company itself is standalone and will be operating in Miami.
Gotcha. Well, very good. So, beautiful. Thanks for bringing that transmitter by.
Sure, not a problem.
And if folks want to see that here at the NAB, there's an Alenos 305 booth in the central hall.
That's correct. Just look up in the air and you'll see our big sign, and that's the easiest way
and,
to
and
find
to
us.
And to test the screwdriver short test,
just
you got a screwdriver
by.
There?
We've got them. I don't have it here, but it's in the booth.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Come on by. Yeah, we've got it. And I don't know if we can find a spray bottle, but hey, maybe one of these will work.
Well, I'd like to just take the RF cable coming out and put it in my coffee, kind of get it warmed up a little bit.
There you go.
That would work well.
2 kilowatts. That's, I wonder how long that would take.
Nice.
Not long
go,
at all.
There you go.
So a little high pot testing at the booth.
That's
yeah.
right. There
yeah.
you go. That's good.
Tom Hartnett, thank you very much again for being with
Thanks
us
having
on the
me.
Show. And we'll come see you in a little while and do
we'll
a,
see you soon.
A more extended interview.
Yeah.
Thank
Kirk,
you very
I know
much.
We've been trying to do this for a long time. I'm glad we finally made it
I'm
happen.
Glad you, I'd love to have you on the show as a
Let's
guest sometime.
It. That would be
Just
great.
Just Skype at your house and you
very
can
fine.
Get, fill us in on all these great tips.
Okay, very good. That sounds
right.
great.
Thanks a lot, John.
Thanks,
Take
guys.
Care.
Excellent.
Thank you very much.
All right. You are watching This Week in Radio Tech live from NAB 2012. I'm Kirk Harnack and my co-host here.
I'm Chris Tobin.
Yeah, thanks for being here.
Well, I'm having a good time.
We've got
It's a great show, actually. This year, I think, is more interesting than it was last year. I'm not sure why. Just the energy feels different.
It does. And, you know, last year our format was a bit different. We had quite a few guests who were here for the whole show.
This is true. This is
and
true.
And this time it's just you and me, and we have some rotating guests
in and out. I like that approach that Comrex is taking to rid the airwaves of nasal-sounding phone calls.
Yeah, that's really smart.
Well, actually, it is smart for both, you know, Comrex and also for Telos and several others do hybrids and stuff. Mm-hmm. When you think about it, the average listener, no matter what age, doesn't matter, and an environment they're in, mm-hmm. is so pristine, when you think about it, in mm-hmm. our terms anyway, I mean, it's average, that you can hear the subtleties of a poor quality phone call. That, you know, yeah. When I say subtleties, I mean the ringing sounds, the pops, the clicks, I thought that person said something, because now with most cellular technology, the vocoders are so small in sampling, you barely get intelligibility.
Right.
You know, so if you're in a noisy environment, say like a convention floor, the microphones get overloaded.
It's picking up all this noise and trying to, doesn't know the difference between noise and voice.
Right. And the nice thing is all the smartphones themselves have microphones that are high quality. So if you have the proper codec behind it, you can manage the audio. So I like the approach that
Comrex is doing is they've introduced this notion of having your callers, your listener callers, your audience.
Right.
Have the capability to call in with high quality, and I think this is intriguing. The notion of using G722 is new, but it's not exactly new. On the Telos VX system, you can put a G722 app on an iPhone, and have a, and that was our thought, to have reporters call in. But Tom's idea is great about having the listeners call in.
I think the listeners, it puts the control in the listener's hand, which is what they've always wanted. They've never have been able to, because, you know, you call a 100 and you have somebody in the office or the booth hitting the buttons, and, you know, well, we assume it's 100. So now with the digital technology with SIP, you can do a lot more and have some fun at it. And I think it makes sense. I think it makes total sense. And the way things are going, SIP technology is the future for telephony.
Yeah. At least from what I've seen and people I've talked with. So I like that. Like the little app, it's like, you go, boop.
You know, I concerning SIP, I want to point something that we've just been discovering at Telos. We've been installing and helping customers install a VoIP phone system, SIP-based, and that's called the Telos VX. And we've talked about it here. They sponsored the show. And what we're finding out is at the moment in the SIP, in the business of SIP providers, and such, we're kind of in the bad old days of little differences and subtleties in standards.
Yes, absolutely.
And so some companies, a SIP provider, like you want to get your phone lines at your business or at your radio station converted over to SIP trunks, right? And they may come in over your internet connection, a dedicated internet connection, or maybe the provider is also in the wire cable business and they're going to bring you their own, you know, from XO Communications or something like that. They're going to bring you that connection. But here's what I'm getting at. The way you order SIP and the way the customer and the SIP provider understand what's being delivered is still a little shaky.
Well, that's, you know, for many of us who've done ISDN back in the early days, we call provisioning.
Yep.
And there was another name they had, and depending on which provisioning you told the phone carrier, you know, M, D, C, and all the others, dictated what kind of quality connection you could create. And the ISDN's the same way. So I think, and since the SIP technology is somewhat based with folks from the telecom industry, they've just taken the four letters of ISDN, removed it, put SIP, and continue with the same model of business. And yes, you call up, and I'm looking for this service. And really? Okay, well, we could do this and this. And you're like, no, I need this. I don't know what you're talking about. Well, it's part of the SIP protocol. No, it's not. We do it this way. Yeah, I know you do, but it's also available if you do it this way. No, it's not. Sort of like ISDN was.
Yeah,
can I have a switch data connection? We don't do that. We do voice. No, just switch data. Okay, I'll do voice as well, but I want both. 2B plus D.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
Think about it.
I remember those days, with ISDN. Although I think it got better toward the end.
It did. When they were starting to phase it out, it got much better.
But SIP is kind of the same way. Right now,
absolutely.
There can be a lot of miscommunication about ordering it, getting it provisioned right.
Yeah.
They're almost two camps. There's the SIP provider, and whether it's a SIP PBX or a SIP service, there's the kind of the old school camp of companies that have had to move to SIP, didn't necessarily want to. They liked the good old days of TDM proprietary stuff, and now our customers are asking for SIP. Okay, let's make a checkbox. Yeah, we do SIP.
Right.
Well, it may not be well thought out, but we do SIP. Then there's the other providers, new PBX companies and new SIP providers who are interested in doing it very standards-based with a good quality of service from the people taking your order, the people installing it. So again, we're in these bad old days, and it's going to sort itself out.
It will.
But for right now, it takes a little
effort. Well, I think for our audience, for the engineers and the techies and those who are just interested in what we do, the best thing is if you're familiar with ISDN ordering, take that same approach that you did with ISDN, apply it to SIP, knowing that there's more options, and just be patient. But if once you get it under your belt and you really work with the SIP, it's great. You can do so much. As Tom's application points out, it makes total sense. You've now extended the experience. Here we go with the artist experience for HD.
Yeah.
Now we've extended the experience out to the audience on the phone call side. So if I'm a sports guy doing sports talk and my basic bread and butter is the caller, now you can have a real nice conversation. I'd sit there going, is that your dog in the background? Oh, no, that's a bad connection. You can actually have a conversation like you and I are sitting next to each other.
Yeah.
And sound like that, even though they're miles away. Yeah. I think programmers that really get it will look at this and go, wow, the engineering departments need to step up and realize this is a revenue-generating opportunity. Okay, it's a non-traditional revenue, NTR, for those in the audience that get that.
Mm-hmm.
And this is smart. So I think it's going to be fun. And as you pointed out, reporters could use the same thing. So if you're a news operation or a news talk operation, you have your reporters using the same technology. I think it makes sense.
For engineers who need to learn about SIP, there's a number of do-it-yourself ways to get this done. One way that I really like is a tutorial about SIP written from the broadcaster's point of view. And this is in the book that Steve Church, the founder of Telos, and Skip Peasy wrote together IP Audio. And it's available from Focal Press. And it's in the NAB bookstore. It's also available on Amazon. It's if you just Google Steve Church, Skip Peasy, and IP Audio, you'll find the book. And that book, I believe it's chapter 6. It talks all about SIP, and certainly from a standards SIP point of view, but also from the point of view of a broadcast engineer. And my goodness, if you're a broadcast engineer and you don't know about SIP yet, you need to learn about it.
Oh, yes, yes.
If you go on just on YouTube and search for SIP education or SIP tutorial, you're going to find all kinds of videos.
Yes, absolutely.
About that.
Yes.
Which segues wonderfully into my next subject.
Here we go. The segues continue.
That's right. We have as our next guest here on This Week in Radio Tech, Randy Hall. Hi, Randy.
Good morning.
How are you? Also known as K7AGE.
That's it.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Good morning.
Morning. How's it going?
I'm great. And I want to remind our viewers who haven't heard about this yet that the way that I met you was a little bit less than a year ago.
August.
I'm in a hotel room in Petaluma, California, and I am going to take a general class FCC license for an amateur radio that morning.
Right.
And I haven't had a chance to study until that morning. My test is in, you know, an hour and a half.
Cram.
Time to cram, right? And so I have Leo Laporte lent me his book that Gordon West wrote,
right,
with all basically test questions and answers with explanations. I don't have time to go through this whole thing. I need to look up the parts that I know I don't know.
Right.
Okay? So I start, and I run across a technology called PSK31. I've heard of this, but I don't know all about it. I thought, man, I'm really interested in that. So I get on the laptop, get on YouTube. I want to find a tutorial about PSK31. So I type that in. And there's one there with a bunch of hits. I thought, okay, must be good. I'll watch that.
Yeah.
So I watched this video about PSK31 technology. And it, you know, in 7 or 8, 9 minutes, the guy walks me through the whole thing. I didn't really pay much attention to who the guy was, what
just
he looked like.
Guy.
Sure.
Yeah.
Just this guy. Just this guy.
Just this radio guy. Yeah.
So get in the car, drive to the TWiT brick house, the brick TWiT house, whatever it is, and go in the door, and there's the guy. He's right there.
And you come up to me and go, Randy, you're the YouTube guy.
Yeah,
I'm just watching you.
So, are you making a business out of this? Or how are you, what's your motivation for making educational videos on YouTube where you tell engineers about the technologies they need to know about?
I kind of got started doing different things on there. And my first video was just a tour of my ham shack.
Ah, okay.
So I had a little camera, and I shot a bunch of stuff. Then I got an airplane and went to Beijing for one of these types of shows there.
Yeah, yeah.
And when you go through that much time zone difference, you need things to do at 3 o'clock in the morning when you wake up. So I had the camera, and I had a FireWire card. I had no idea what I could do with this thing, and I plugged it into the laptop, and Windows Movie Maker popped up and said, would you like to import, you know, the data?
Yeah,
you know, the clips.
Yeah.
I go, okay. Well, so I brought it all in. And I pieced it together and put a little sound effects on it, and I posted it up on YouTube. You know, and I come back the next day and look, there's 250 views. You know, and it just kept going up. So then I started doing a lot of the early videos of just me operating, working different DX stations and kind of putting a map up and some of this type of stuff. And some of it was originally just the web camera, so it looked really poor and poor audio, but, you know, the views kept going up. Then I did the PSK one. And I found out that the people really enjoy the videos how to do something, where they can learn something new. Mm-hmm. In the PSK series, there's 5 of them posted up there, as well as the satellite series, where I show people how to work through the ham satellites. Those have well over 100,000 views now. The total is about 2.1 million.
Uh-huh.
And with over 6,200 subscribers.
Wow. Wow.
So
over a million views of your various one, if you aggregate, over 2 million views.
2.1, yes, okay. Total, yeah.
So you understand a lot of different technologies because you're very interested in them yourself.
Yeah.
And it's your passion, apparently, to help other folks understand what you know about them.
Yeah, and that's been, the ones I really like to do now, which I haven't done very many recently, is the ones I show people how to do things. And it ends up being kind of a large project time to get it all planned out and shot and put together. You know, I know how much work George does every week for the Ham Nation show, so it requires a lot of time to do it right. But I have some more ideas. The one I want to do next is one basically resources for people who want to become hams, where to go. So okay. like the ARL site, their books and things, the Gordon West books. There's a fellow, I forget his name now, has a whole series of YouTube videos about each one of the sections in the license manual.
Oh, okay.
Jerry, Katie, KB0BIK, I believe, has the same type of thing as an audio podcast. I want to pull all those resources together to direct people who want to get their license. You know, here's some places to go look.
Yeah.
So that's kind of what I want to do next.
Well, I'm excited about people like you and other, actually other allied technologies. If you need to know about something about, well, I mentioned SIP telephony.
Yeah.
But if you need to know about something about servers or about clustering computers together,
mm-hmm.
there's an amazing amount of stuff on YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
And you really turned me on to the value of learning from YouTube.
Thanks.
So have other people like Salman Khan, right, who does the whole Khan Academy stuff. So if I need to review quadratic equations, you know, well, they're right there.
Right.
You know, or covalent processes in chemistry.
Right.
But broadcast engineers can stand to learn a lot about these allied technologies,
right.
computer servers. Not that we have PSK31 in broadcast,
right.
but there are other RF technologies and,
right.
and power amplifiers and antenna technologies that you can learn from by watching these YouTube videos.
And something else I end up helping a lot of people with is how to troubleshoot things, because now they're trying to get their PSK stuff working.
Uh-huh.
So I get emails almost every day, you know, how do I do this, or I'm having trouble with this interface, so, you know, that's a constant feedback circuit they're going.
So when you do a YouTube video, do you expect to be the support department then for that concept?
It can work out for that way. That's one of the reasons I haven't done an echo link.
Oh, yeah.
Because setting up the firewall ports.
Firewall.
Yeah,
sure.
On your router and stuff. And George has just done that on one of the amateur logic things. Mm-hmm. And I said, it'll be interesting to see how many, emails for support you get. Because I watched the EchoLink mailing list, and that's always a constant.
People ask about port forwarding?
Yeah.
You know, that's a great subject. And that's been a subject. Fortunately, I'm fairly familiar with that concept.
Mm-hmm.
I've been doing it for a long time to access computers in American Samoa. Since we own a radio, we own two stations
sure.
there, we have to access a number of different computers. And if you just install, VNC or PC Anywhere on a computer, you're not going to be able to access remotely without opening up ports.
Right.
And because it's not one of these rendezvous server-based programs. So that was a thing that I learned about early on. Well, it turns out that for so many things that broadcasters want to do and need to do, you need to understand the concept of ports and how to forward ports. Companies like Comrex and Telos are making it easy to use devices without forwarding ports by using external rendezvous servers.
Sure.
But yet you get better performance in many ways if you go ahead and
get
that direct connection.
Right.
So if you're interested in that, I'm passionate about that subject because it's so important for broadcasters. And there are already videos on YouTube about how to do this, what the concepts are, and how to actually get it done.
Yeah, it's like I had to dig into that more for myself because I had a video about remote controlling my radio station.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So I use LogMeIn to get to the PC, but I have to turn the PC on. So the PC I had at that time, you could set the BIOS so it would turn on with power.
Okay.
So I bought a 8-outlet power strip that each outlet is controlled via internet connection.
Yeah,
So it basically has a web server in there. So you have to connect to it to the IP of your router, then colon, and the port that you forward on through. Of course,
exactly.
Now the trick is, what is the IP address for your router?
Ah, then you've got the dynamic IP type services.
Right, because something happens, and so I have the no IP running on a computer that's up all the time.
Yeah.
Just so
yeah.
I know how to find the other
computer. Well, and now there's routers that have that functionality built in, too.
Yeah.
So you can have the possibility of not having to leave a computer on and still getting the IP address updated via a service in the router.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and you go through the show floor here, and anything that has knobs or a display on it probably has an Ethernet port.
Yeah.
It's everywhere.
And if you want to be able to control that inside the building, usually not a problem.
Right.
But if you want to control it from externally, either it's got to run through a rendezvous server, which opens up ports like that, which there can be some security issues there.
Sure.
Of course, just opening up a port, there can be a security issue there. And I harp on this subject all the time. But if, for example, I keep using PC Anywhere as an example. If PC Anywhere wants you to open up port, I don't know, 5610,
yeah,
don't do it. Change it to a different port number. Something random and high, yeah, like 59,267. And open and tell PC Anywhere to use that port and open up that port on your router and mm-hmm. forward it. And then, voila, you sure. are more secure from the script kiddies
yeah.
than you would be using the standard ports.
Right. So,
wow.
Cool.
Well, Randy, it's great to have you on the show.
Okay, well, thanks for having me by.
Is there anything else that you'd love to talk about? Anything else you're passionate about?
I don't know what your time is, or you're just about out, so you have to wrap up here. So thanks for having me on. I'll see you tonight.
Folks, yes, at the Ham Reception.
And
there is also a TWiRT meetup at 5 o'clock.
5 o'clock?
At the Telos stand.
I will be there.
Also, if folks want to meet Randy online via his YouTube videos, go to YouTube. And you can search for him easily by typing in his ham call, which is K7AGE, Kilo 7, Alpha Golf Echo. Kilo 7, there we go. Yeah, hello. K7AGE. And lots of good videos there from,
thank you.
Sorry about that. Taking that just a bit of time. Thanks again, Randy.
All right.
Appreciate you
very much.
We'll
see you tonight.
Okay.
Thanks
you're, Randy.
You're watching This Week in Radio Tech, and we're just about to wrap up this episode that's been going on for 2 hours. We've been here for 2 hours, Chris?
2 hours, yes.
Goodness gracious.
Absolutely.
We've had some nice people to talk to, so it went by fast.
Went much faster than I thought, which is good.
Yes. Yeah.
It's good. It's Wednesday, and the show's got, what, another day? Yeah, another half a day.
You brought some show and tell. And
it was just a quick little thing.
We can... Can we go another 2-3 minutes?
Yeah, sure. All right.
Let's do it. What'd you bring here?
All right. As I did last year, we were talking about video and compression and video over IP.
Yeah,
so this is the box, not this exact one, but this is the model from last year that was just basically available. We didn't have it plugged into anything.
Right.
Didn't have all the different options. So now it has a battery option.
Okay.
And I'm waiting for my little phone to set up so I can do a little quick demonstration. But the idea behind this is it's a two-camera input, and you can do H.264 MPEG-4 over IP.
Okay.
As low as 128 kilobits, as high as 2 megabits, or actually 3 megabits. And remote control capabilities for those in the audience that are familiar with.
Ooh.
This is a Sony brand. Canon makes one. Panasonic makes one.
Okay.
They've got pan, tilt, zoom cameras, PTZs.
Oh, yeah.
So with the RS-232 connection, you can remote control.
So you can switch your video and remote to the cameras,
You
too?
Can remote into the unit through either web browser to switch the video.
Okay.
And then this is your control of the cameras and whatever feature sets are on here.
Right,
so
right.
If the feature set is camera switching, then so be it.
Okay.
But if it's not. And what was cool, what's nice about it is if you want to do a remote location, say for a talk interview, mm-hmm. For TV, I'm working with a university with this unit where they can actually set up a small room, green screen if they choose. If not, they just leave it a nice room. And they just have their guests go over there.
Yeah.
And then they remote into the unit. And with the pan tilt zoom control, guess what?
Yeah.
They can do everything.
And they don't need a technician
Nobody,
there?
No. They don't need a technician there unless they want it as just a safety.
Yeah.
But the cost is less.
Yeah.
And but it, cost aside, staffing aside, what it offers you is an opportunity to do stuff quicker. Like a friend of mine who does video work, he was telling me they're looking at maybe possibly getting this for their operation because he says right now we want to do an interview. Say like this. Say we want to introduce somebody to the show remotely.
Right.
We have to contact a crew, schedule it. Hopefully they're available.
Yeah.
And then you'll get all that going. So you're talking 3 or 4 day lead time.
Right.
This type of technology, and there's other companies that do something similar, but not in this form factor. You now have this box sitting in a room. You remote into it. You got two cameras if you choose, or one. And then you're up and running. So if you have an ad hoc moment, you're like, oh, wow, get them over to the studio on 7th Street. Boom. 20 minutes later, you got a guy up and running.
Wow.
So now, and that's the IP side of things.
Yeah.
I was going to show, I'm showing you talk about the flexibilities and stuff. And so far, the folks have been talking, I've been talking to them like, wow, that's a whole different thing. That's what we were saying earlier. Look at the technology, look at the workflow. When I was saying with HD radio, hey, I got artist and title, but I've got 6 different systems that get it to the guy's radio. that's not the way to do it. So this is sort of like a similar thing. It's like, okay, one box, 2 cameras. I have a guy somewhere remotely. I'm up running.
Would you typically use the same IP connection to remote control that and to deliver video back?
You can, yes. It's designed to do that. Or you can do the second LAN port, and then it has a control. And then you can make that the control side.
Now, okay, educate the radio guy here.
Yeah.
If you had a little studio set up, as you mentioned,
mm-hmm.
that people can go, that somebody would go to our 7th Street studio, There's got to be return audio, obviously.
Yeah, there's bidirectional audio and video.
Oh, but that's my question. There's bidirectional video, too.
Yes.
Okay, so you would hook a monitor to that and the return video.
Well, I'm not going to spin it because of the camera position, but if you look, there's two monitors on it, so actually you don't even have to add one.
Oh, okay, so that can be just turned toward the guest.
The monitor on this side is the inputs 1 and 2. You select on the front panel.
Okay.
The monitor on this side is the return video and the local video being encoded. So you can see if there are any artifacts or what the qualities will look like at the data rate you've chosen.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm saying it's self-contained. It's pretty convenient. And we've actually had some radio stations looking at it. But, you know, it's a TV product. But it was a radio station came by 2 days ago.
Mm-hmm.
You know, told him the price. He's like, okay, it's kind of high. But then all of a sudden he's talking to his finance guy. And they're talking about, well, you know, we do these remotes from these clubs and some other event 3-4 times a year, and we get X number of dollars.
Yeah.
What if we could do video and we could add that to the website? And we could do it? All of a sudden, the cost of the unit was no longer a question.
Yeah.
It was because they said, we could pay for it in a year with these remotes. And I sat there, I'm looking at it, I'm excited because I'm like, oh, finally, a radio guy that's like looking at beyond just the, well, I'm radio, I don't do video.
Right.
You know, it's
right. Smart. Smart.
Yeah. So let me see if this. So if for if, fun, I wanted to show something. Let me see if this works.
If folks want to see that, you have a booth here, right?
Yes, we do. CCS Video is at SU3302.
That's the South Hall.
South Hall. So if you're in this
SU is upstairs.
Upstairs. So if you're in this hall, just go to the escalator and go up.
Okay.
Just go past General Dynamics, and you'll see us.
All right.
But if you want, I'll quickly see if I can make this happen. I'm actually tethered to my LTE phone to demonstrate the LTE technology.
You have any LTE actual throughput here with all these people?
Yes.
Really?
I've been averaging about 8 megabits per second in both directions.
Oh, my goodness.
The problem is it's dealing with Verizon, though.
Oh.
So let's see if this works. If it doesn't work, then that's all I can do. Verizon's been very very wacky about their network. And let's see if it comes up.
And if this works, we're going to have what, live video from next week?
You'll have live video from either my booth or from WFAN in New York City.
Oh, okay. All right.
But I'm at the mercy of the phone company at the moment, as we talked earlier.
I hear you.
All right. Let's see what happens.
Sorry, I wasn't prepared to vamp.
That's okay. I was dealing with the phone itself. I had no choice. But there are technologies. Comrex has a technology also that is something similar, but on the back of a camera.
Yeah.
Called a live shot.
Yeah.
So that application is more of, you know, jump and go to a story. And you have DSI. There's a company called DSI RF. They have something called the New Shark. That also is a camera mount.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. I've seen that. Yeah.
So, you know, those are two. Then you have the, like here at TWiT, you have a live view. Yeah. And it's TVU Networks, which is a little larger footprint.
Yeah.
So, you know, depending on your application, you pick and choose the tool for the job. So, let's see. Now this might work. So, you know, learning about the phone companies and the wireless needs and what they think is right and wrong has been interesting. We have been talking to Verizon about wireless LTE and machine-to-machine technologies, which is what we're all doing here, and it's fascinating. They're starting to understand the broadcast mindset.
Yeah.
So let's see if we can make this happen real quick. Make everybody happy. Here we go. It's also this is the web browser you can see. I didn't have the luxury of giving you a video out for the screen.
And we've got a camera trained on...
Yes, we do.
Okay.
Yes. Let's see if we can make this happen.
I'll just see
it.
It'll
be fun. Right. If not, it's just the way it goes in live television. Okay, something should be there.
Yes.
That is the booth of... That's across from my booth.
Okay.
SU3302. So that's here at the hall.
The camera's in your booth.
Yes, the camera's in our booth. So you... that's it.
And this is coming over your LTE phone.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
The signal path is the LTE phone.
As I pull out the connection.
Look at that.
You can see in the screen the data rate. The screen will tell you the data rate.
Okay.
It's decoding. Mm-hmm. And it says 1,000. That's 1 megabit.
And this box is in the CCS video booth.
Yes.
We got to go. We're past time. Thanks a lot for being here.
Oh, you're welcome.
Appreciate it very much.
Thank
I'll probably see you next week, right?
Yes, you will. Okay.
You've been watching This Week in Radio Tech live from NAB 2012. I'm Kirk Harnack. Chris Tobin's been the guest here. And coming up next on the TWiT Network, Leo's here, and we got a lot more good programming live from NAB 2012. I want to thank our sponsor, Telos Omnia and Axia, for sponsoring TWiRT. And we'll see you next week on This Week in Radio Tech. Bye-bye, everyone.